Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
How do you bring down a free society? How do you enslave a planet? Well, you finance radicals, you fund them, you turn them loose, you give them safe havens, and then you create giant defense spending platforms and set up giant spy grids in the name of protecting the public from the threat. And here we are, all these years after 9/11, and we are supposedly more unsafe now than ever, despite the trampling of our liberties, and our governments never get in trouble when we get attacked. They just get more promotions and more elaborate budgets. And if you ask what's going on with ISIS, that's it. We've seen a more than quadrupling of Islamic immigrants into Europe since 9/11. We've seen a doubling, according to the Justice Department and, of course, Congress and different groups that break down the numbers, ICE and others, to this country. Now, again, I personally do not think that the average Muslim wants to blow stuff up and kill people. But the dominant culture in Islam now is run out of Saudi Arabia and is a vein of Islam known as Wahhabism, which is, of course, a sector of the majority system of Islam, which is Sunni. Now, a lot of people are asking me, you know, is this an inside job? And the answer is yes, but not in the traditional fashion. It could be, but the evidence is pointing towards this being spillover out of Islamic State's jihad that's been funded and turned loose across Africa and the Middle East, as well as areas of Asia. And so this system has been turned loose, and the system knows that the public is so politically ignorant and so politically dumbed down that when the very groups our governments have been funding attack us, the response won't be, hey, we should prosecute the politicians like Hillary Clinton that were neck deep in all this. Hey, we should have congressional hearings. Hey, we shouldn't have been doing this all along. Hey, we should be releasing the 28 pages of the 9/11 Commission. But instead, we're told the answer is take out Assad, who for 5 years has been fighting al-Qaeda, al-Nusra, now known as Islamic State. Now, I want to open the phones up early in this hour, even ahead of Paul Watson and Joe Biggs with crew joining us from Paris, France. They, of course, gave us live coverage yesterday during the Sunday broadcast, 4 to 6 p.m. Central. They'll be joining us at the bottom of the hour into the next hour, interspersed with your phone calls, 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231, specifically on what do you think about the situation in France and other Islamic State terror attacks happening across the world, and the controlled media's attempt to act like it's not Islamic terror to continue the open borders and the flood of so-called refugees. 800-259-9231. But it is a false flag in that our government's helped fund and create these groups, open the borders up, advertised freebies, and let people come in, and then demonized anyone and everyone who exposed that this would be coming, that this would be happening. So there is blood on the hands. In every angle you look at, of Barack Obama, of the French president, of the German Chancellor Merkel, and of these other European leaders that went along with this. Separately, if you get Italian members of the Senate or French members of the Senate or French members of their parliament or even Rob Lowe coming out and saying, boy, I should have shut your borders before this, there is all this fake consternation and outrage like the people that were proven right are somehow horrible demons. This is an attempt, again, to overturn reality because globalism is insanity. It is at war with reality. Is it the beginning of a new holy war? The Crusades, the clash of civilizations dreamed of in the year 2000 by Dick Cheney and the authors of the PNAC report, Rebuilding America's Defenses? Or is it a global crisis out of which planetary police state and a cashless society will be established? It's both, my friends. Thank you for joining us on this Monday live worldwide broadcast, the 16th day of November 2015. Our intrepid reporters, Paul Joseph Watson, Michael Zimmerman, and of course, Joe Biggs, will be joining us from Paris, France, in about 25 minutes from now. I intend to also start going to your phone calls to get your take on the situation. But here's the big picture analysis right now. We know the West funded and created ISIS out of Al-Qaeda groups in Syria. We know they gave them weapons. We know our own military came out in the last 2 years and refused to support it. ISIS then, it appears, turned partially against the West, Saudi Arabian-backed, and turned against Iraq to then loot that area and set up their caliphate. There is some evidence now that the French and others have actually turned against ISIS and are bombing them, hence the retaliatory response on Friday the 13th in Paris. Again, we're not 100% sure about that. We are speculating, but the evidence is mounting. Here's a Daily Mail article. Putin comes in from the cold. Desperate world leaders cozy up to Russian president to get him to join the fight against ISIS. Again, there's that spin that he hasn't been fighting ISIS. Barack Obama seen sharing a joke with Russian president at G20. David Cameron meets Vladimir Putin one-on-one for the first time in a year. I mean, they've kicked him out of the G8. They've been moving weapons in against the Russian border. And now the Saudi Arabians have been threatening Europe, threatening Russia, threatening everybody, that if they aren't given Syria, and if they aren't given part of Iraq, they are going to throw giant fits and activate terror groups they've got all over the world. WorldNet Daily says, France goes to war with ISIS, start of World War III. We're going to get Dr. Corsi on very, very soon to break all of that down. But this is the crisis that the big mega banks will clearly use, along with other crises, to bring in their planetary regime. It's about playing nation states off against each other. It's about deindustrializing countries. It's about bringing areas of the world back to the Dark Ages. But all of that said, here is the overarching issue, the lever with which we, the people, not just of the United States, but of the world, of Europe, of the Middle East, of Africa, of Latin America, of Asia, of the South Pacific, from Australia to Chile, from northern Canada to Russia, from Portugal to Austin, Texas. It doesn't matter where you are, this affects you. Whether you're in South Africa or Japan, whether you're in Mongolia or Turkey, it doesn't matter, this affects you. Governing by crisis, governing by chaos, governing by fear-mongering, governing by centralizing control, governing by a security state. If you've got a military-industrial complex that Eisenhower, of course, warned about, that gets trillions and trillions of dollars a year just in the United States alone, and that governs by fear, and that is owned by private banks and private families, what do you need? You need chaos to stay in control. And I'm tweeting this as we speak. I wrote it during the break at Real Alex Jones. Obama has blood on his hands for funding and protecting ISIS in Syria. WikiLeaks is right. And there's the tweet. Just went out. Obama has blood on his hands in Paris for helping to create ISIS. WikiLeaks was right. And you click on that article from the weekend, WikiLeaks has been demonized as saying that America was to blame for the attacks. But when you scroll down to what WikiLeaks actually said, they said Western governments are to blame because they helped feed ISIS. That's what WikiLeaks had to say. And ladies and gentlemen, that is a fact. And we talked about this since Benghazi happened in 2012. We asked over and over and over again, how are they going to get away with funding Al-Qaeda in Syria and all over the Middle East, and of course in Libya, launching all these attacks? And what happens when they then attack the West and our own government's created it? How will they get away with it? They will say that we're unpatriotic. They will say that we're blaming America and the American flag. No, we're blaming the criminals that have taken over our government that are involved in all this. And I believe the establishment has bit off more than they can chew. Obama is preparing the climate with the open borders, with the Syrian refugees coming in, for terror attacks in America that will be used to expand the NDAA, the Patriot Act, all of it. And then common sense and logic will be suspended, and no one will say, why did you help create these groups? Why did you fund them? Why did you bring them in? We just saw hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people. Some estimates are over 300,000 killed in Syria. Low estimates, about 180,000. In the last 5 years, with the, quote, good rebels, who are al-Nusra slash al-Qaeda, attacking and murdering and bombing and killing everyone and blowing up every church they can find. Who humanizes all those Christians that are being killed? Who humanizes all those priests being murdered? Who humanizes all the women that don't wear hoods on their heads being killed? Who humanizes all the Africans in Libya who've been killed by the tens of thousands by these very groups? Who humanizes them? No one. But you get 130-something dead in a whole bunch of, in a string of attacks inside France, and you'd think it's the end of the world because they're now going to misdirect our energies to go into Syria and actually aid the very people who have been there attacking that sovereign nation and those innocent people for almost 5 years. And if that happens successfully, that is the triumph of abject, total, and complete ignorance of the people, and the sky's the limit. It is what George Orwell warned about, 1984, come true. It is 2 + 2 = 5. It is mass insanity. It is mass mental illness. Our criminal occupational government, our occupied, captured government, is clearly planning another string of terror attacks in Europe, in the United States, and other countries. And by planning it, they're bringing in the people that will do it, just as sure as the sun comes up in the morning. And when they attack us, we'll be told it's our way of life, what's left of freedom, that has to be sacrificed when we've trampled our freedom, but they've left the borders wide open to bring in unlimited refugees from all over the world and told us we got to pay for it. This is rubbing our noses in it in an arrogant way I personally have never seen. It is a breaking of our will. So, the White House, because that's where the buck stops, and the National Security Council directed the policy, just as Europe has, under UN edict, under the UN migration head, borders and migration head, has dissolved our borders and our sovereignty, and are the authors, are the kingpins, are the bosses, are the mafia dons. Peter Sutherland of the United Nations, Barack Obama, President of the United States, the French president, the German chancellor, Merkel, all of them are to blame and have blood on their hands directly and knowingly. And they're going to have more blood on their hands when there's more terror attacks in this country. And common sense is suspended when they're telling you they got to have checkpoints on random highways and got to feel you up at the airport, have to spy on your internet activity and watch your shopping purchases while the border stays wide open and the radicals pour in by the millions across Europe and the United States. And it's in the millions from all different parts of the world. It's all coming up. I'm going to take your phone calls when we come back from break. Please remember, and I want to thank you all for your support. You're making it all possible. It's very expensive to send four people to Paris, France, to report and investigate on the ground. So when you buy the super high-quality water filtration systems, non-GMO heirloom seeds, Patriot apparel, pro-gun T-shirts, high-quality nutraceuticals, films, books, you name it, high-quality storable foods, survival supplies, at InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com, you make everything we do here possible. And I put the call out yesterday for support, and we did see that come in, so thank you. We need a lot more support. We salute you and thank you all. Please check out the specials. We have 15% off on the amazing sleep aid, 9 different known formulas, organic and concentrated to really give you restful deep sleep, from valerian root to L-tryptophan to melatonin and more. Find out why Knockout, we believe, is one of the best high-quality products out there. For the cost of just a bottle of melatonin, you get 9 other ingredients and the same strength. Also, we've got the Living Defense. We'll probably sell out this week. Parasite Cleanse, that's available. An amazing product, InfoWarsLife.com. Or call toll-free to ask any questions or about specials, 888-253-3139. Your calls are straight ahead. I've got to say it, it really is bold of the West to fund Saudi Arabian Wahhabist Sunnis, give them a couple different names to confuse the public, turn them loose to murder every Christian they can find, and then to watch them attack the West, as we've been predicting ad nauseum they would, and then grandstand and talk about how much they love us. I don't really watch NFL football, but Darren McBreen said he watched 3 games yesterday, one of our reporters. He wants to do a report on it later. He said every game they would show Apache helicopters fly over or F-16s fly over and would a moment of silence for the dead French comrades and then cut to French troops by our troops. Now, I'm all for a moment of silence for the French. I'm against the 130-something dead. I think it's terrible. We tried to stop it happening. But now the state just uses it for pure propaganda to prop up the criminals we've got. It's just crazy how they've dumbed the debate down. And, of course, we told you this years ago. It was admitted earlier last month that millions of dollars are paid a year per team in some cases. Tens of millions of dollars a year total to engage in those patriotic displays. It's all fake. You know, if the NFL's so patriotic, they should not be paid to do it. Oh, by the way, it's come out, they're also paid to do anti-gun pieces and to have their reporters make anti-gun statements. You do understand that when I plug during the segments and I openly talk about a product, I'm being honest with product placement. Talk radio's honest about it. When you watch the NFL or NHL or NBA or Good Morning America or any of these shows, almost all of it is paid. They're reading off a teleprompter when they talk about a movie or they talk about a book or they go, oh, let's look at these cosmetics or, oh, let's look at this blender or, oh, I really like President Obama or, oh, I'm really upset about guns. They are going through a teleprompter. By the way, I've been on these national sets. I've seen it. But it's admitted. And they'll have like one paragraph and a fake debate, and they're told what to say, be upset, be happy. It's all fake, 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 fake. And if I tell people this, they tell the average yuppie, that's a conspiracy theory, none of it's fake. It's all fake, people. It's paid for. I get up here and say, this hour brought to you by, and tell you who it's brought to you by. And they do that, too, on these shows, but that's nothing. So that's what folks should be aware of, and it's not just selling products. It's selling anti-family, anti-male, anti-private property, anti-gun, anti-conservative, anti-libertarian. And then they'll talk about how much they love the troops to get you to join the military, but then have the propaganda that once you're out of the military, you can't be trusted and might be a terrorist. And all the TV shows and all the movies and all the stuff now, which is about federalizing police and promoting Black Lives Matters and all this stuff. Of course Black Lives Matter when they're being aborted by the millions. or wasn't fluoride. But, oh, no, we're never supposed to worry about those black lives. Just the handful of blacks being killed wrongly by police, that becomes the biggest issue in the world because it's meant to create racial division. And I know you know that, but this is balkanization. Let's at least get one call in now. Then I'm going to come back and into all the breaking news, stuff we've not been covering while the crisis is happening, which is the big kickoff for more terror, make no mistake, and more. And our reporters joining us. Jay in Pennsylvania, thanks for calling today. You're on the air.
All right, man. Thanks to be on. I know you said that you weren't sure if Paris was a false flag, but there's some mounting evidence come out. There's this guy, Patrick Pelu, first name Patrick, last name spelled P-E-L-L-O-U-X. He was an EMT and witness at Charlie Hebdo. And he's on France Info Radio, which is like their mainstream radio, like it's like NPR here. And he's saying that they had a multi-site exercise planned for that morning. And, quote, they were prepared as luck would have it. And he's in the radio saying this.
Wow. Well, I've always said, if there's a drill at the exact same place at the same time, that's your sign it's at least partially staged, because they use that to cover up the operation if anybody gets caught by another agency or group. That's the cover story. So you're telling me that on major French radio, they're saying that the Hebdo attack of last year or this theater attack was a drill?
No, right. This guy was he's a current EMT and he was a witness.
No, there it is. Hebdo. It's on. We're going to post the whole article from Global Research. Well, we're affiliated with them. We'll post the whole article. We were prepared. Counterterrorism emergency exercise on multi-site attacks took place on the same day as Paris terrorist attacks. So we'll see if that happened directly at the same area, because then it really bumps up into false flag territory. We know the CIA head was meeting with the French intelligence head as well, and a lot more. We're on the mark. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I've already broken down the basic facts. The West opened up the borders publicly. The head of the UN program said it is about ending European sovereignty as we know it. It is about world government. There is a giant world government conference coming up next month in Paris, the most important, the UN says, in their history. The Pope has announced 3 months ago that world government and global taxation with a world court and world army will be announced and finally ratified at this event. The TPP has been passed and completed without the public being able to see it. Of course, on record as well, we are living in epic times. And on top of it all, Black Lives Matter supporters release F the Paris rap song. Black Lives Matter activists upset the massacre, removed media attention from Mizzou protests. And it's a large group. Breitbart's reported on it. We reported on it even before they did. But I got to say, Breitbart found the memes that they were putting out from like 100 years ago, showing French soldiers with dead Africans, implying somehow that these international people at a concert deserved it. I mean, it's crazy. In fact, show the Breitbart one for TV viewers, the Breitbart article on Black Lives Matter's doubles down is the headline, says F Paris. And you look at the memes, I mean, it's crazy, folks. It's pure racism. Because French soldiers went around conquering areas of Africa 100 years ago, now the French deserve to be machine gunned and bombed, even though most of them were foreigners at a rock concert. White-on-white crime, what France thinks about blacks. And then it shows stuff from Angola and things with the French, as if other armies didn't put other people's heads on sticks. And then it continues on, showing illustrations from actually 200 plus years ago, saying, well, France basically deserves this. I mean, this is sick. It's like weird tit for tat stuff. And it is pure racism. This is what's being promoted. In fact, I want to take those memes that Breitbart had and add them to Paul Watson's article, because it really illustrates the type of craziness that the left has engineered, where the left brings in the outside populations into Europe, hypes them all up full of hatred of white people and hatred of Christianity, and then lets them have a free-for-all. Then turns around and deploys a police state on the French, on the Germans. And then Black Lives Matter is throwing fits because they want more attention because of the infamous poop swastika. And somebody might have heard of racist slang once. And weird statements about how dare you give more attention to this white tragedy than the black tragedy. Nobody got killed at the college. Just absolute insanity. Meanwhile, talk about more evidence of an inside job, more evidence of prior knowledge. Terrorist involved in Paris attacks was previously charged by Interpol, AFP and others are reporting. It is known that the international terrorism warrant was issued for one of the attackers by Interpol. Here is another report out of the Times of India. Paris attack. Police stopped Paris attack suspect near Belgian border hours after the killing, but let him go. And then it goes on to report that they were brought in, at least some of them, as Syrian refugees who weren't even Syrian, who made it on boat lifts, who were rescued from boat lifts off the coast of Greece months ago. And so you're saved? Africa won't even go out and save the boats when they come back. They won't even take people that flee. But when Europe takes you, the answer is attack with hand grenades and shoot people. Now, again, the caller earlier was saying, we don't know if this was a false flag, a staged event, a self-inflicted wound or not. The fact that the media wasn't ready to jump on this with scripts within minutes is one sign it wasn't. The fact that there was a general anti-terror drill going on in Paris, that's now been confirmed, that day points towards it being a false flag. The fact that the CIA director was there meeting with the head of French intelligence that day, very suspicious. The fact that France was just starting to step up its attacks in Syria, suspicious, unless you just think it's ISIS striking back. We have our reporters on the ground. We'll get their takes on that in just a moment. But here's what I'm getting across to everyone. This is the fault. I don't even know if you call it a false flag. This is the fault of the West because they created the climate. They opened the borders. They advertised the freebies. They said, come here. They accepted the fake passports. They let the military-aged men in. They let the radicals in. ISIS said in February, we're going to flood you with 500,000 immigrants. They said they were going to do this. And so now it's happened. A month ago, the ISIS head said, we've now infiltrated you, prepare for attacks. So this is definitely something where we can say the blood of these dead people is on the establishment's hands. And now, as I said earlier, will they get away with the new attacks that are going to come? Will the people responsible for this get away with it? The French president, the German chancellor, the American president, all of them are guilty. The Greek government, the Turkish government being a conduit out of Syria. Every jihadi you can imagine goes to Syria. They got their butt kicked. So now they're allowed to come through Turkey and they're allowed to infiltrate Europe. That's what's going on, ladies and gentlemen, period. We now take you live to Paris, where they've got burning refugee centers, more soft target attacks, stabbing shootings, burnings are happening, but it's being kept very quiet. Some French are responding back, attacking some of the, quote, refugees. Some Muslim businesses have been shot up in different parts of the U.S. This is all part of the class of civilizations warming up. Now, has this gotten out of control for the establishment? Or is it going according to plan, always with piercing analysis? Paul Joseph Watson joining us from downtown Paris. Paul, I just set the table. What do you make of all this?
Well, I think the biggest story, Alex, to emerge today out of these attacks, out of Paris and France in general, is the fact that we've had these huge raids across the country and also in Belgium. In fact, there's some interesting video, which is on Joe Biggs' Facebook page, from an army source that we're going to investigate more later, which shows apparently some of these terrorists being killed with one of them still alive. That's not being shown on the major news networks, as far as I'm aware, so we're going to look into that further. But yeah, huge raids across the country. And remember, going back to Charlie Hebdo, there was a guy who got up on Fox News, a terror expert called Steve Emerson, and he said that these jihadist cells, these radicalized cells, are going to emerge out of, quote, no-go Muslim areas of Paris. What happened to him at the time, this terror expert? He was laughed at by the entirety of the mass media. Fox News was actually sued by the mayor of Paris for, quote, Islamophobia, merely for this guest saying there are no-go Muslim areas where these cells are being radicalized. So what do you see today across France and in Belgium, in Molenbeek? Muslim ghettos, no-go areas where the Belgian government admits they've completely lost control of these areas. That's where the plot for this event unfolded, in those ghettos in Belgium and some in Paris. So that's the major story to emerge out of today, because 3 months ago, Infowars.com reported that French security experts were basically preparing the army, warning that they were drilling to reapportion areas of the city to claim them back from these radicalized communities, these jihadists. The weapons are flowing in from Libya. So as near as 3 months ago, they were preparing to take back these communities that would rise up in the event of being radicalized. And that's exactly what's happening. That's why they're now being raided today. But we were laughed at for warning about that a year ago, Charlie Hebdo. And everyone was called Islamophobic simply for drawing attention to it. Again, we were proven deadly accurate. So I think that's the biggest story to emerge out of events today.
And we're showing this incredibly dramatic footage of the raids taking place. And I was reading another Defense Department report on this just yesterday, where they were saying that the weird rapper gangster culture in these ghettos of Muslims all over the world is mutating to where they're not even really Muslims. They're more of like a gangbanger death cult. It's just totally disgusting.
Yeah, and then, of course, you've got the flip side, which is the middle class in countries like Germany being radicalized. Again, top security.
Again, Paul Watson reporting from Paris, France. His Skype broke up for a moment. We will reconnect with him and go back. Then Joe Biggs will be joining us after we take phone calls in the next hour as they move to another position. But again, ladies and gentlemen, this is unprecedented. And Putin has put the establishment in check by actually going in and striking real ISIS targets and their al-Nusra, al-Qaeda command bases. Putin comes in from the cold. Desperate world leaders cozy up to Russian president to get him to join the fight against ISIS. Barack Obama seen sharing a joke with the Russian president at G20. David Cameron met with him on one-on-one. Paul Watson, what do you make of the Russia situation and what's happening in Turkey right now with the G20?
Well, they're all cozying up to Putin, aren't they? They're all trying to save face because, of course, 2-3 months ago, he launched the massive offensive against ISIS. So now, after, you know, trying to shun him for several weeks, they're trying to cozy up to him. Hollande has achieved the unimaginable of making himself look stronger than another world leader. Of course, he said it was an act of war. And now Obama is cozying up to him. But Hollande is making Obama look weak because at least Hollande has some good rhetoric. Then you've got another video which you might want to play, which is on my Twitter stream, which is a reporter actually confronted Obama today while he was doing a speech at this G20 and said, you said ISIS was the JV team. Now what do you say in the aftermath of this? We need to destroy these, quote, bastards. Somebody said that in front of Obama as a direct question during a conference today. So basically Obama's reeling, his reputation is reeling. And yet still we've got this attitude. Again, this is Salon.com. We see this from them all the time. This is a headline yesterday. Do the Paris attacks mean it's time to accept more refugees in Europe? This is Salon.com. Muslims in Europe are marginalized and maligned by right-wing nationalists. Can we stop terror attacks by making them feel more at home by accepting more Muslims in Europe? So again, they're basically saying, oh, the poor marginalized ISIS jihadists, we're being too insensitive to them. We need to bring more of their buddies over to make them feel more comfortable. That's the attitude of this again, cuckolded left wing that we see again and again.
Let me raise that. What do you make of Madonna saying it's the West's fault, we should love the jihadis, it's our fault? And then Rob Lowe simply tweets, oh, now France closes its border. That's all he said, and he's being crucified as a demon. You see, what they're doing is so over the top that they have to attack reality and act like normal behavior is outrageous, because what they're doing is outrageous, Paul.
Yeah, and then you've got the cultural flip side where we talked about Black Lives Matter. Again, you mentioned it earlier. We've got a rapper who is a Black Lives Matter supporter coming out with a song called F Paris. Again, on the back of this Twitter trend, which emerged yesterday, which we reported on. And basically, they claimed that this was all just, you know, anti-Black Lives Matter people getting outraged about this, which was why it started trending. That's not the case, as you saw with our article and the Breitbart article. These were actual BLM race-baiting activists that started that. And now just, what, 2-3 days after the terror attacks, somebody releases a song saying F Paris. The leader, the de facto leader of Black Lives Matter, D. Ray McKesson, came out and said, this is comparable, this equates, the massacre of 130-plus people equates to what was happening at Mizzou, equates to somebody drawing a poop swastika on a bathroom wall, equates to somebody yelling, allegedly, a racial slur out of a pickup truck. That's the de facto of Black Lives Matter saying that.
Well, exactly. And folks, there are bad things happening to some black people in this country. We stand against that. But it's blown a trillion times out of proportion. It's Soros run. And that's why we totally stand against Black Lives Matter, because it is a nasty, evil organization, so hateful that it would make sick jokes and celebrate the dead French. And it just, and by the way, dead Europeans and dead Africans, a bunch of people got killed. It was a very diverse group. This just shows, if they'll say this in public, how hateful and nasty are these people in reality. Paul, you mentioned the reporter during Obama's speech today, just a few hours ago. He then took questions from the International Press Corps. Here is the powerful exchange where a reporter tears into ISIS in front of Barack Obama.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I wanted to go back to something that you said to Margaret earlier when you said that you have not underestimated ISIS's abilities. This is an organization that you once described as a JV team that evolved into a force that has now occupied territory in Iraq and Syria and is now able to use that safe haven to launch attacks in other parts of the world. How is that not underestimating their capabilities, and how is that contained, quite frankly? And I think a lot of Americans have this frustration that they see that the United States has the greatest military in the world. It has the backing of nearly every other country in the world when it comes to taking on ISIS. And I guess the question is, and if you'll forgive the language, it is, why can't we take out these bastards?
Well, Jim, I just spent the last three questions answering that very question.
That's enough. Shut up. Look, Saudi Arabia runs it. The West is funding it. We've had the former head of defense intelligence go public and say they were ordered to support them. That's what's happening. And now they're being intimidated and squeezed by Russia into responding. And now ISIS has gone crazy. And I believe this is ISIS directed. It's their MO and has done this. So does this show an internal split? Is ISIS now bucking the West, saying stop putting heat on us? Or what do you make of the CIA being on site? What do you make of there being a drill? What is the motive for a Western false flag where they bare minimum let these people attack? Because we know they opened the borders. We know they brought them in. We know they had weapons, Paul. We're skipping this network break. Bare minimum, they knew this something like this would happen, Paul. I mean, what's going on? Is the foreign policy really just unraveling?
Well, it's blowback on a massive scale, isn't it? We've been warning about it for 18 months. We were called racist. We were called Islamophobic. And now it's happening, which is why I'm not led to believe that it's a false flag, because it was all too predictable. I mean, you had one of the bombers coming through a Greek island. Of course, they found the Syrian passport, but they tracked him. They were able to tell that he came in through that Greek island via his fingerprints. So that's one example. There are a lot of these conspiracy theories. They say, how could the passport have survived the blast? Well, they identified him via his fingerprints, which were also taken in Greece when he came into the country back through Syria. So he's positively been identified as somebody. Whether he was Syrian or not, doesn't matter. He abused this refugee, this migrant wave, that now EU Commission head Juncker says will continue to happen. Merkel says it will continue to happen. They say we must be tolerant of the migrants. And here's another statement which I just tweeted out earlier. This is from the Grand Mufti there in Australia. Remember we had these top imams in Jerusalem saying, we're going to abuse this migrant wave to breed out Western populations. That's how we're going to conquer them. Again, those were his words, not mine. A top imam in Jerusalem said that a couple of months ago. Now we've got the Grand Mufti out of Australia saying that unless France tackles Islamophobia and racism, then more of these attacks will happen. That's the Grand Mufti. You know, it's basically a threat. Not saying you should crack down on them, not saying you should go after them, defeat this ideology that's causing these attacks, but that you should cut back on Islamophobia. Okay, you look at each incident, 9/11, Madrid train bombings, London bombings, Charlie Hebdo, this attack. There's been no mass wave of Islamophobia. Muslims aren't getting attacked on the streets of Paris. You know, there are sporadic incidents, a few fires here and there at the refugee centers. There's been no mass wave of, you know, citizen Islamophobic attacks on Muslim people. So when they bring that concern...
Again, Paul Watson. Okay, your Skype was breaking up. Continue, Paul Watson.
You know, Muslim people are not, you know, they're not going to be any more safe than they are here.
Paul, I want to take some calls, and I want you guys to get repositioned, take about a 10-minute break, and then I'm going to come back with Joe Biggs at 8 after in the next hour. Then I'm going to let you guys obviously finish up your reporting or go get some dinner or whatever you need to do. But you say you had no trouble getting into France, neither did Joe Biggs. Obviously, Interpol's got all your data via your passport. Have you had any other issues with police since you've been on the ground? I say that because... we've had issues with cameras in England and in Spain, where they basically banned having cameras on the streets as a form of cracking down on the press. Overall, what signs of a police state, if any, have you seen in Paris?
Well, there's some security guys right behind us now. They seem pretty jovial. They're not like trying to stop us film. But from what I've seen arriving, I haven't seen any military on the streets. I've seen, you know, police with guns, which basically looked like weak rifles. We knew the police were complaining after Charlie Hebdo they didn't have enough firepower to take on these terrorists. But in general, the security is more relaxed than I expected it to be. Biggs arrived a few hours earlier, and it's not as intense as you would expect, given what we've seen and what happened on Friday night. But Biggs and Michael visited the theater, the site of the theater attack, which you can't really get too close to. But again, there's not too many police around there, and Biggs will tell you about that later, but it's not as intense as you would suspect. Certainly, if you compare it to London, which, of course, we visited a couple of weeks after the 7/7 bombings, where basically everywhere we went, simply for taking photographs of flowers in a tube station, we were harassed by the police. We were harassed by the police for filming anywhere. So far, and we've only been here since yesterday, no harassment. So that's interesting.
Well, anybody that understands real terrorism when it does happen knows that giving up your freedom, taking people's rights, setting up checkpoints everywhere does not protect you. It never has. You've got to go after who's actually stirring it up, who's causing it, and you don't give it a bunch of political attention to basically empower those that have been involved in it. I think the jury's out on whether this was completely staged or not. I don't think it was from the evidence we have mounting. There is kind of a leftist attempt to take over the, quote, conspiracy movement. That just means questioning movement. And to basically brand any type of Islamic misbehavior as a conspiracy theory. No, it's a fact that ISIS has been murdering hundreds of thousands of people, along with al-Nusra and al-Qaeda, same group. And our government's been supporting it. That's the real conspiracy. And the real conspiracy is opening the borders and bringing them in to do it. Which I just think shows the incredible arrogance. They don't care if ISIS kills people. They'll just take more of our rights. And they think the public's so dumb that the politicians won't be held accountable. But, Paul, there's real anger taking place right now. And I think the establishment has miscalculated. I think Merkel's in trouble. I think the French president's in trouble. No matter how much patriotic garbage they involve themselves in, I think you should talk to folks on the street. A lot of them speak English there and ask, you know, is your government responsible for opening the borders? I mean, your French president... closing them now just for, you know, a few months or whatever, that's too little too late.
Well, yeah, and Hollande, of course, is massively unpopular anyway because he's basically wrecked the economy. So he's going to be out in the next election. And again, as I said yesterday, Marine Le Pen is going to win the first round. She's going to do well in the regional elections coming up here, but they've got a national election in 2017. She's almost certain to win the first round. Then the establishment's going to come in and say that this is going to represent a bigger threat than, you know, Islamic radicalization, because she's the only one really in France who is calling for the radical extremist mosque to be shut down, who is calling for the migrant wave to be turned back. And she's got huge and growing support here in France. Of course, she distanced herself from her father, who was seen as more right-wing, more radical. So they're starting to attract more moderate support. There's the Pegida movement in Germany, which is starting to attract more, quote, moderate support. So, you know, a conservative wave is sweeping Europe. It has been for the past year, 18 months. And that's what the political elite, the establishment, are terrified of. And these attacks only bolster the will on behalf of many more.
That's right. That's right. All right. Paul Watson, Skype is cut out. We'll talk to Joe Biggs coming up at 8 after next hour. I'm going to take some phone calls when we come back. And then after Biggs leaves us, John and Jennifer and Aaron and Maya and Eli and everybody, we're going to go to you. So please be patient. Briefly, this hour is brought to you by Survival Shield Nascent Iodine X2, the purest, cleanest iodine that we could ever find. We don't know of anyone else who puts iodine out this pure. It's like 99999. It is extremely powerful. It is the good halogen that obviously in your glands blocks the fluoride, the chlorine, all the rest of it. Such a game changer. Learn more at InfoWarsLife.com. See the informational videos. A healthy body and healthy mind from California says in a review, this stuff is powerful. I take it every day. My body loves the effects. Everybody needs it. And this is the best form of product to take. Hit the order button before it's gone. Thank you for your review. Matt in Aurora says, started giving it to my kids. I've seen a dramatic increase in productivity in my youngest schoolwork. Kids love it. I love it. I would recommend it to a friend. That's Matt in Aurora. So that's InfoWarsLife.com. Those are both five-star reviews. InfoWarsLife.com. And your purchases of T-shirts, books, films, water filters, hundreds of items at InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, funds this whole operation. So I salute you and thank you. We'll be back with the second hour. I'm taking some of your phone calls right now on the Paris attacks. Just amazing to see the children of the Western governments, these al-Qaeda people attacking, and the mainstream media is not pointing that out. WikiLeaks does and gets demonized. John in Florida, you're on the air. Thanks for holding. Thanks for calling. What's your take on the situation?
Well, okay, thanks for taking my call, Alex. You know, my take on this is desperate people do desperate things. I mean, you know, when you look back on this, and I just say to myself, you know, these people appeared out of nowhere. I mean, a convoy as far as the eye could see of Toyotas. And come on, man. They got to know who sold them those Toyotas. I mean, come on. This is outrageous. But I'll go with it another way, in the sense that one of the things I've been wondering is you've got this rate hike coming up, supposedly, on December 10th. And I've been wondering, how are they going to do that? They can't do that. But by the same token, they're going to have some reason why they can't. And right on cue, Alex, right on cue, all over the financial TV this morning. Well, I don't know they're going to be able to do that now. You know, I mean, the bottom line here is we're bankrupt. And the reason why we're bankrupt is because the money is all debt. And you've reached debt saturation. And by the way, Alex, don't think that China don't want this too. They want this world war just like the Pope has said we're in World War III. They want it too because they know they got to off about a good billion of their people. And they can't do it themselves. They got to have a boogeyman, too. And we're going to serve the purpose of that boogeyman.
Man, you're a good caller. I mean, everything you're saying makes perfect sense. And the globalists say their problem's managing billions of people, feeding us, keeping the resources going. All they do is complain about having to, quote, take care of us. The elite have already stolen the planet financially. They think they own it. They think we're in the way. And all they talk about is ways to off us. In fact, I remember Mao Zedong saying, it's a famous quote, we're the only country that could survive and prosper from a nuclear war. And then his replacement made similar comments as well. So what you said is a very informed statement.
And what they're obviously, you know, you brought up some good points in previous shows about how the machines are replacing people. This is the reason for the carbon tax, because you cannot have a money system based on debt that is supported by income taxes. Income taxes require growth. They don't want growth anymore. This is the reason for carbon tax.
That's right.
Because they get rid of the population and still tax the people to support whatever new money system they come up with. But there's a reason why you have zero interest rates. You know what that is? Because that is the value of the money. The value of the money is zero, and it's inherent in the fact that the rate is zero. If the money had value, then, I mean, think about it. If somebody gives you something for nothing, what's the value in it to them? It's
nothing.
Nothing. That's the whole problem that we have here now. America cannot get back to where we were because now with 3D printing and I mean, the machines are going to take over. We don't need people to do all these things
anymore.
And
by the way, at the bottom of the hour, we have the writer, Charles Arthur, who wrote the big London Guardian article, coming on. Artificial intelligence, Homo sapiens, will be split into a handful of gods and the rest of us, and how the elite also plan to just get rid of the population. In fact, will you guys print me Bill Joy's Why the Future Doesn't Need Us article? Thank you, from 16 years ago. Because this is the real, not debate, but decision that was come to by the 60s. And we're now living in this plan and getting pretty deep into it. So you're absolutely right. And that's the message I try to get out to people, is that a planetary government's being established, not to create prosperity and help us go to the stars, but to end humanity as we know it. The decision has been made that we're a failed species, and the elite believe they will transcend us in a transcendence. Talk about a delusional power trip. We'll be back. Great call. Well, one thing is certain. A group of things are certain. Infowars.com predicted exactly what's unfolding with the Russian aircraft going down, the attacks on theaters, the attacks on Army, Navy, Marine Corps recruiting centers here, and the fact that the media is basically not even pointing out that our own governments are bringing these people in, that multiple attackers have been identified as refugees. And it was also predictable they would just say, hey, give up your rights now, we'll keep you safe, but with your borders wide open. Simply amazing. Now, coming up at the bottom of the hour, we're going to shift gears for 30 minutes into artificial intelligence. Homo sapiens will be split into a handful of gods and the rest of us. That's a London Guardian article I covered last week. We have the author, Charles Arthur, on. This is what the elites are saying. And speaking of elites, the French government is talking about not having workers at all and being all robots within just a few years. What's the point of that? We'll talk about the end game coming up. And of course, we're going to go to Aaron. We're going to go to Maya. We're going to go to Eli. We're going to go to all the folks that are holding as well on the Paris attacks. But popping in is Joe Biggs, who's been filing prolific reports from on the ground in Paris, France, with his unique military perspective, being a combat veteran, staff sergeant of Iraq and Afghanistan, multiple Purple Hearts, dealing with these very same types of folks. We do now know about drills they were having. That's being reported by Global Research. That's just general drills. We also know that the CIA head was there the day of the event, but does that mean a pure false flag? Why does it matter? They brought him in to begin with. So the government's to blame regardless. Debate over. Joe Biggs.
Yes, I don't believe that it's a false flag attack whatsoever. You know, like Paul said earlier, this has been building up to where it is now. You know, you could see this coming from a mile away. And just like in a fight, Alex, what do? You find a person's weak spot, and you continue to hit that spot. You know, Paris is pretty much a very weak spot when you look at it all around, so it's easy for these guys to carry out these attacks in this area, and that's why I think they'll continue. I mean, you have the Prime Minister of France coming out today saying to the people to stay vigilant, that they think that there'll be another attack. And then you also have the President of France coming out saying that these acts...
Feed breaking up to Joe Biggs. You should come back in a moment. Hold on, Joe. We'll come back to you in just a second. And I tend to agree with him. Again, there's real terrorism, folks. But still, it doesn't matter. Our criminal governments allowed it in? And it's not the government low-level's fault. It's the high-level leaders. Joe, you're back.
Yes, I agree. I mean, definitely there's a lot of people up top having a part in what's going on. But at the same time, you know, if people had the ability to protect themselves, a lot of these things wouldn't happen. And it just seems like the governments out there, they don't want that to happen. They want to let the borders wide open. And the fact that you want to come out and call that racist or Islamophobic is completely mind-blowing. I don't understand how you can come to that conclusion. You know, the fact that these attacks keep happening, and like Paul said, you don't see a large amount of these Muslims are out here getting beat up or anything like that, but you're seeing a lot of attacks from these Islamic terrorist groups, but yet when you call them out on it, you're Islamophobic, you're a bigot, you're a racist, and that's the craziness that's going on in the world right now.
Well, a lot of the Black Lives Matter groups are getting more intense. They're not apologizing for saying F Paris. They're saying these are white people. They deserve it.
Yeah, that's disgusting. I mean, number one, the guy, DeRay McKesson, I can't stand that guy. He's a worthless person and the so-called leader of Black Lives Matter. You know, there are a few people in that movement, I think, that have a pure heart who really want to make some kind of change. But that entire movement has been hijacked. It's nothing
sure, and,
more
and,
than
and a lot of the low-level people are just thugs and criminals or folks that are upset and angry. And they're being manipulated by the mainstream media that legitimizes all of this.
It's disgusting how you can compare a massacre to a poop swastika on a wall. Really? That brought you the pain of losing family members, loved ones, friends that'll never come home, friends that you thought you would see after a concert, but it'll never come back again. You know, so many people wishing they had that last chance to say final words, but these people are complaining and whining because of something drawn on a wall.
The definition is spoiled, rotten babies when they complain, we're not getting attention.
It's not just at Mizzou. Go to University of Texas. Go to all of these colleges around the world. It is ridiculous what is being taught, much less the brainwashing going on and the fact that these people are not smart enough to see past that propaganda and come out with a clear, precise thought on really what's going on. They can't see past it.
Well, how could you not empathize with hundreds of people shot up who they don't even know who they are? I mean, a bunch of them are, quote, minorities. It's bizarre. Joe, you're going to have more reports you're filing, but before we leave you and go to calls, other information that you've dug up.
Well, I mean, it's interesting right here. If you actually look at the top of Drudge, it says Paris attack puts dagger through heart of liberal Europe, which is correct. France warned about terrorists twice before a strike. Bomber's mother, my son blew himself up because he was stressed. What kind of BS is that? Really, you were stressed out, so you decided to strap a bomb on you and go kill a whole bunch of innocent people? That is ridiculous.
Well, you heard Madonna. She said that it's our fault. We need to love these people.
Yeah, it's our fault, yeah. But you know what? Props to Governor Abbott. He wrote a letter to President Obama today saying that Texas will not take in Syrian refugees, and I'm glad that I remembered this. But if you actually look at one of the local papers in Louisville, Kentucky, they will be taking on 12 Syrian refugees, I think, in the next couple days. And they're expecting those numbers to double over the next course of a few months. So you still have people out there that are ignoring the fact that this stuff is happening. Not saying that every single one of those refugees coming over is bad, but all it takes is one, and that one person to go in and plant a seed and start up a team and to carry out something that happened like here
sure.
in Paris
well,
on
there's
Friday.
There's over 100 different sites where they're coming to. And again, if it was all women and children, or they could prove they were really Christian refugees or non-radical refugees, most of them are men. They're pouring in. They've got fake passports. Our government knows this. So when they want to stick their hands down my pants to fly on a plane, it's all just theater.
Well, now you have this new ISIS video out that came out today saying that their next target will indeed be the heart of America in Washington, D.C., so, you know, it's definitely going to be interesting to see how this plays out, if this is part of the fear game propaganda, what's going to happen out of this.
Joe Biggs reporting from Paris, France. Thank you so much. Be safe. We'll be following your reports at Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. There goes Joe Biggs.
People here cannot drive.
That's another issue you've noticed?
God almighty.
All right, we'll be talking to Joe Moore. There he is in Paris, France. I'll get into some of the other stories that are up on Infowars.com after the break, but right now let's go to Aaron in Washington, who's been holding patiently. Aaron, thanks for calling in on this Monday edition. Go ahead.
Hi, Alex. Good to talk to you. Aloha from Washington State. Just said it just perfectly. God Almighty. Hallelujah. First of all, I want to say God bless you in Jesus' name and everybody listening. I just pray that everybody would have wisdom about this and not look at this whole Paris thing one-dimensionally, but realize, I mean, you've really got to have a mind to see the spirit that we are, just really traveling in a physical vehicle, you know, to get the full comprehension of what's going on here. It is so complex. You know, Alex, you know, as smart as you are, your 3 hours still wouldn't cover it. You could do a 10-hour documentary on the complexities of these things. And, you know, I really wish Stan Monteith was still around with us to talk about things like this, because his perspective was really wise and blessed to have. But, yeah, I just want to encourage brothers and sisters, you know, good Christians, pray for each other, but pray for your enemies as well, as we're told to do. And walk faithfully. You know, King Solomon wrote that when a man's ways please the Lord, he will even make his enemies to be his footstool. So we need to continue living faithfully and strong.
Well, amen to that. I agree with you. Specifically, do you have any views about the attacks and where all this is going? I mean, I just don't see how Western governments won't be held accountable when they're the ones that did this on purpose and advertised, come here, you can get all these freebies, and then let people in with fake passports. They don't let me into the U.S. with a fake passport. They don't let me into Europe with a fake passport. I mean, this is deliberately done. So is it just to rub our faces in it and see what they can get away with?
Well, yes, Alex. We all know that they have, you know, multiple purposes, multiple benefits for these things. And one of them is to, you know, serve as a distraction also to the big elephants in the room. You know, there's a few of them. The whole climate conference is going to be going on soon. Yeah, the fact that you pointed out, they really instigated this whole thing. You know, like a demented zookeeper, you know, letting out certain animals to go fight each other. You know, that's kind of the satanic tactics that they use. And, oh, by the way, I really liked your analysis the other day on the Friday the 13th and the connection to the Knights. You know, that was my first instinct as well was, you know, as soon as I heard the breaking news, Friday the 13th, you know, start looking for those satanic signals.
Sure.
You know,
I appreciate your call. We got to go to break, Aaron. We're going to come back and talk to Maya and others. But I should have covered that more yesterday. I probably should today in a viral report. I put out Saturday, I just spent a few minutes on the fact that first I noticed it was Friday the 13th, and the Russian airliner destruction was on Halloween. So that's kind of a globalist occultic date. But then I started thinking, wait a minute, Friday the 13th originates back in the 1300s when the Knights Templar got rounded up by the King of France and the Pope on Friday the 13th. And then they were burned at the stake. And that's where, if you just type in origin of Friday the 13th, that's where Friday the 13th first comes from as being unlucky, is the date that pretty much the leaders of the Crusades were rounded up, double-crossed, and killed. And that was on October 13th, Friday, October 13th, 1307. Philip IV of France arrested hundreds of the Knights Templar and then again had them killed. A bunch of them ran to England and Scotland and basically moved the power base over there. But there's some other messages going on here. It's not just Friday the 13th, folks. It's in Paris where the origin of the date comes from. Those really, I don't think, are coincidences. And the same thing with the Halloween situation. Again, it's not even about governments, folks. It's like specter groups, global corporate groups, the UN, the IMF, World Bank, Bilderberg. That's how they operate. It really is crazy to see our Western governments fund Al-Qaeda, turn them loose to run around murdering people in four or five countries. Then they start attacking us, and they grandstand about America stands with France, and we're going to help take out ISIS. Hollande. And then he's been instrumental in open borders, and he's grandstanding. It shows how stupid they think we are, but I don't think we're as dumb as they think. Maya in Kansas, you're on the air. Welcome.
Hi. Thank you for taking my call. I'm going to try and get as much in as I can.
Yeah, go
Please
ahead.
Forgive me for not, you know, being as good on this, but it seems to me like we need to, in order to understand what's happening now, we need to take a look at the end result of past skirmishes. And I've gone back as far as 2003 at what happened between Bush's actions in Iraq. And some of the key players then are the key players now, with the exception of a few, like Holbrook, who died of a heart attack, who for the most part, he played a big part in the post-recovery after everything that took place in 2003. Obama did not like him. As a matter of fact, if it wasn't for Hillary Clinton, they would have removed he would have removed Holbrook.
Yeah, Richard C. Holbrook. So what are you getting at with this?
What I'm saying is basically is that the countries that were owed a great deal of money by Iraq, okay, Iraq was in debt to a lot of countries,
yes,
including France, Germany, Japan, on and on and on. I have a feeling that what we're looking at here is the beginning of a major grab. And that in a lot of
I get it, because France has now been struck. It's going to get to have part of the oil fields in Iraq. Same thing with Germany. Same thing with others. Well, they've always divided Iraq up from the beginning of the 2000, invasions, all of it. So absolutely. I mean, we have the invasions. We have the situations that took place then. We have the stuff that happened back in the 1990s. You're absolutely on target. Maya, I appreciate your call. Let's go ahead and talk to Eli in Montana. Eli, you're on the air.
How's it going?
Good. Go ahead.
All right. So I saw an article up on MarketWatch yesterday that says, after the Paris attacks, it's time to form a world court and a world organization to go after terrorist groups and all of these, unfavorables. Now, what do you think of this world court? I know you mentioned it earlier, but I want to get your take on what you see happening, because we always go to Joe Biggs or Paul Joseph Watson, and what do you see as the end game here with the U.S. and Russia and France and all of them supporting going after ISIS and other groups, asterisk.
Okay, well, we did put the article that you mentioned on screen, and we'll put it back up on screen, from MarketWatch. There is the headline with the establishment calling for international legal unit to fight terrorism. And so that is global government. And they've already basically set this up, but they want to fully ratify it and trot it out to the world in December, just in a few weeks, in Paris. And so I think I give my view and opinion all the time, but you're saying I was getting Joe Biggs' view and Paul Watson's take on all this. This is order out of chaos. It's what I said last hour. This is funding terror groups, and they don't even care if they end up striking us, because then they'll just take our freedoms away. So I think that's what it comes down to. In fact, that's what we see unfolding. We predicted everything that's happening. It's not hard to predict. So that's my view on this. What do you think?
Well, I think, a lot of people died on 9/11. I think a lot of people died in France and Kenya and Beirut over the last week. And I think this is going to be justification for the next round of Patriot Acts and blackbagging people. And
I totally agree. And it will be the excuse for the open world government court that we have been talking about. And absolutely. So the question is, did they stage the whole event? Or did they just let them come in and attack us and open the door? Either way, the criminals that have hijacked our governments are guilty. No one can disagree with that. It is a fact. So the next question is, are we going to let them get away with it? That's the question.
Hell no.
So we got our work cut out for us. God bless you, Eli. Appreciate your call. Now I'm going to shift gears for 30 minutes. I'm going to shift gears on two different subjects. Here, dealing with the future of humanity straight ahead. And then we'll come back in the third hour with more of your phone calls, 800-259-9231. I'm Alex Jones, your host. Infowars.com is the news website. Please don't take the site for granted. Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central, we're here live, broadcasting across the United States. The global audience tuning in to audio and video. at Infowars.com/show. Well, Charles Arthur has been a journalist writing about science and technology for more than 20 years. And he's been working at The Guardian since 2005 as the newspaper's technology editor and is still a contributing writer to The Guardian. And I'm not going to go over his lengthy bio, but the overspill.wordpress.com, charlesarthur.com is also one of his websites. And I saw an excellent lengthy article last week. Artificial intelligence, Homo sapiens, will be split into a handful of gods and the rest of us. A new report suggests that the marriage of artificial intelligence and robotics could replace so many jobs that the era of mass employment could come to an end. Well, the media is basically saying this is kind of a new thing. And it certainly is more popular to talk about now because it's actually starting to arrive, at least the first stages of it. But if you go back to 1999, here's an article we've talked a lot about. Bill Joy, Why the Future Doesn't Need Us. This has discussions of the elite discussing just getting rid of everybody. And, of course, you could argue 7.5 billion people are chewing up the earth. But then so many people that aren't even part of the establishment say, yeah, get rid of the people. Well, who's going to do that? It's kind of like in the remake of Superman has a eugenics plot to it, and Zod, General Zod, is talking to the chief scientist of the planet, and he says, these degenerate bloodlines and overpopulated planet, I'm going to exterminate all these scum. And he says, who's going to decide? You, Zod? So see, therein lies the problem. And then once you start deciding, don't build a planet for people, build a social engineered planet, well, now you've got a technocracy controlling what info people get. Isn't that the ultimate tyranny? Then I see the elite trying to dumb us down to build us in the image they've claimed we are. And I don't see the elite merging with machines and becoming God when they have that type of attitude. But I'm ranting. Charles Arthur wrote an excellent article looking at so many angles of the technical end of this, of what's currently happening, what's being projected. Because this isn't like getting rid of, you know, horse and buggy whip factories because we moved to automobiles. This is much, much bigger. And from my research, the social engineering decision's been made to build a world that makes humans obsolete. And that's what Bill Joy said 16 years ago. We'll see what Charles Arthur has to say. Among the work he's done is to jointly create the Free Our Data campaign, which is very important as well, and so much more. So, Charles Arthur, thanks for coming on with us.
Hi there.
Wow, so much to get into. I've been ranting about your article. What got you interested in this particular area?
I was asked to write it by one of the editors at The Guardian. So, but it's a topic that I've been interested in for sort of 30 years or so, about the potential for computer systems to hold the sort of knowledge that people can hold, but are sort of not accurate about holding. So, you know, a doctor has an enormous amount of information that she might know, and that she sort of passes an exam with. But then when it comes to, say, you've been on the emergency call for 30 hours straight, and you're trying to figure out whether some symptoms means one disease or a different disease, you make the mistake about it. And what you would hope is that the computer would actually be accurate in that situation. So that's the sort of thing that I've been interested in. Though this report looks much more wide, it looks at the capability for computers allied to robots, allied to artificial intelligence, to take over a whole lot of jobs that are, in effect, sort of menial, and which actually could be done just as well by computers plus a robot, which would, to some extent, sort of free people from the risks involved in a lot of jobs.
Well, Charles, I mean, I know from Hollywood movies and things, we've been given a dystopic view of this, but look at how screen time is lowering IQ and causing people to neurologically not be as advanced. I mean, there's so many studies on that, it makes my head spin. Look at how calculators have turned us into people that don't know how to engage in basic arithmetic. Look at how so many of the things that have made our lives easier have actually turned us into blobs. I mean, are we going to turn into these little vestigial creatures that just, like something out of the movie Wall-E? That's my concern, is I do see a major dystopic flavor to all of this that I kind of introduced earlier. Do you see any type of dystopic problem with this?
Well, if calculators are the problem, then how is it that we got more advanced technology than we ever had before? It's only since we've had calculators that we've been able to do the sort of work that we used to do. If we were all doing it on slide rules, then I don't think you'd have a Google today. So the tools aren't the problem. It's more what you do with the tools. And the availability of the internet, for example, has meant that people have more access to information and to accurate information than they ever had before. It's simply a question of whether people go to the trouble of actually finding that information and doing the research themselves rather than, say, just stopping at the first couple of links that they find on a search page.
Sure. Well, I agree that technology itself is neutral and overall is good. But even Bill Joy and the Unabomber and others saw big problems with technology basically unseating humanity and making us obsolete.
I'm not sure if I'd take the Unabomber quite as... I don't know if I'd really want to be arguing anything from his side of the fence, because his side of the fence is the complete psychopath. So I don't know. I think I'd leave him out of the equation. I mean, no one has quite found an argument yet which says that we should do away with all the technology because things are better. Because, you know, if you do that, then you could just rewind back to the beginning of the Second World War. There weren't any antibiotics. I have a son who's deaf, for example, who's able to hear through a cochlear implant, which is only developed through in the past 30 years. So in a lot of ways, you know, technology advancement improves things. It's more a question of encouraging people to make use of the information and the potential that's there in order to improve their lives, because when you do that, then things get better. There was a study by the University of London a few years ago which found that fishermen in Tanzania, if they owned a mobile phone, their income rose because they were able to phone ahead to markets and find places that would take their fish for better prices than others. And you can sort of see that if those same people had smartphones, they're able to send pictures of the fish to the markets and they can get better prices even so. So, you know, in that sense, the spread of technology makes things better. What happens, though, is that all the old jobs, the old tedious, dangerous jobs, a lot of those go away. And the bigger question is the one, as you say, sort of a bit about access to information. So in that sense, it's not a great thing if Facebook or Google has access to all our information, or if we feel that they're controlling our information. The important thing there is to have access yourself to information that you can verify against the real world, where you can use scientific method to distinguish cause and effect, and where you have an informed populace. But as to the sort of social effects that computers and robots taking over a lot of jobs has, well, that's really hard to see. And you can imagine that you get a world where fewer people need to work, and possibly you have one where the big corporations, which are raking in all the money because they have the money to spend, are actually taxed on their capital, and that you have a world which is actually more for the benefit of people.
Well, just to be clear, I was not endorsing Theodore Kaczynski. I was quoting him because he's quoted in the Bill Joy Wired magazine article specifically warning of these issues. And I agree. I personally have used technology to be able to unseat a lot of mainstream media and come from nowhere and be much more successful than they are because they didn't know how to use it properly or didn't want to. So I totally agree that medicine, you name it, there's so many great things about it. But in general, looking at a lot of technology, what it's doing is actually dumbing down the population because they're not using it to become empowered or successful. They're using it to just entertain themselves. And that's actually what the Wired magazine article 16 years ago found, that they were already looking at it, was that people would just become basically entertainment heads. And then what do you do with all these people that don't produce when there's these giant robotic systems that produce for them? Do we become kind of like a fungus that just lives within the machine and become vestigial ourselves?
It's an interesting question, I guess. And then the question becomes, well, is that necessarily a bad thing? And the question of whether people are sort of dumbed down. Stephen B. Johnson did an interesting book a few years back called Everything Bad is Good for You. And he looked at trends in IQ scores and children's ability to problem solve. And that suggested that children who did a lot of video games actually became better at problem solving because video games, in essence, consisted of problem-solving task after problem-solving task. So that it's not necessarily the case that a lot of entertainment is of itself a bad thing. It's sure. more how you direct it, and it's more about how you use the educational system to teach people the best ways to work in a connected future. So, I mean, one of the things that I find a little disappointing about a lot of schools at the moment is that they don't teach children about collaborative working, about working across a network, about having to do things that look beyond just taking an exam where you regurgitate what you knew before.
The corporate systems, again, have been looking for robots all along, trying to create biological robots, so now they don't need the biological robots. They can go to real robots, but then what will happen to their human market as the robots take over? But expanding on that, looking at some of those studies about video games making you smarter, that was in groups versus other groups that were just watching television. But I agree with you. A collaborative game where you've got to make decisions and do things is better for your brain, obviously, than just sitting there watching television all day. But I think that's the two sample groups you've got. I mean, obviously, moderate video game play is obviously probably good for your brain. So is doing a lot of different things. But I think people that are watching 5 hours of TV a day and playing 5-6 hours of video games a day, I mean, I know some of those folks, and they don't look too healthy or happy. But I get your point. So do you have overall an optimistic view about the future and about this robot revolution?
I'd say overall that I generally have an optimistic view about our ability to create new job categories that didn't exist before. So, you know, if 10 years ago you'd said to someone, yeah, I'm a social media manager, they would have given you the blankest of blank looks. But today that's a job which is a valid category. You can actually do that, and it has value to some people. And that exists because it's built on top of other technology platforms that have built up in the past 10 years. Although you could also argue that it's just an extension of marketing, that marketing's been around since the 1900s or before. In that sense, nothing changes. So I'm generally optimistic about people's ability to find new ways to sort of pass their time productively. Some people don't want to pass their time productively. I mean, I got to say, I wouldn't recommend watching 5 hours of TV a day to anyone. That way lies madness of many sorts. But in terms of people who are incentivized to work, people who feel that that they've got more to offer the world, that the world has more to offer them, I think that actually, if robots take over making McDonald's burgers and fries, then actually that frees people to do more interesting things where they're interacting with other people, which is much more fun.
My problem is it gives a lot of the big corporations that have proven themselves to be predatory and to be grasping for governmental power the ability to make humans dependent on their industrial combines, and removes a lot of the leverage humans have over the equation. It takes away a lot of grassroots power. But obviously then look at what digital phones do and cameras for grassroots power. For the citizen journalists. So I understand it's a completely and totally double-edged sword. You have a quote here in your article from The Guardian, artificial intelligence, quote, Homo sapiens will be split into a handful of gods and the rest of us. Can you break that down more?
Yeah, I was quoting a guy called Colin Chase, who's written about this topic a few times, and he was saying that the problem of creating these incredibly clever systems, these clever computer systems and allied with robots, becomes something which fewer and fewer companies can do. So you only get a few companies that can do them. So you get a sort of celebrity effect where all the money tends to flow towards them. It all flows up towards one end. You get a very skewed curve, so that you only have a few companies which can do it. And they hire all the people who can do those tasks, which means that no one else can get into it. So in effect, you have a self-reinforcing system. And that's where he sees the sort of split between the gods, who are the companies who can create these systems, and the rest of us, who are in effect using the fruits of their capital, I guess, more than labor, but equally are reliant on it because we can't do it ourselves. I mean, it's an interesting point of view. It's his point of view.
Sure.
And it's to some extent, it's a sort of a pessimistic point of view. It's interesting that last week Google open sourced the code for one of its machine learning systems, the thing called TensorFlow, so that anyone who wants to can build their own machine learning system. And that's a very democratic move on Google's part. It's something which means that smaller companies can get into this. They can try to figure out ways to do it. And actually, the whole machine learning, artificial intelligence space is really hot for venture capitalists at the moment. There's loads and loads of small companies, even just in London, who are being funded like crazy. Google bought one of them.
Sure, it's the ultimate. It's the ultimate gold rush because it's believed that whoever gets it first will be able to take over the world. I mean, just look at what high frequency trading's done. What do you do when they come up with a computer system that can completely game the entire stock market? It's patented. It's owned by one group. That is a majorly disruptive technology. And it looks like the establishment's decided to go ahead and just have this race and let whoever ends up on top end up on top. And who knows what will happen during that process. And, you know, let's just hope this AI system doesn't have, you know, some bugs in it that end up, basically devastating civilization.
But isn't the sort of the let the biggest one win? Isn't that the way that capitalism tends to work? Unless you impose regulation, that's the. I mean, the question then becomes, sure, how do you regulate AI systems?
No, I hear you absolutely, and I'm a capitalist. I'm a capitalist. All I'm saying is that it doesn't matter if a government takes it over, then they'll just be in power. I mean, it's a critical crossroads in human development, obviously, moving towards a singularity. Do you believe we'll actually reach a singularity, Charles?
I don't think so in my lifetime. I think that that's a good, if it can happen, then it's the sort of merging of the human and the computer, where the computer and the human are sort of indistinguishable in terms of their thinking and where they merge their thinking. I think that's very fanciful, because I think that the
Sure, stay there. Final segment with you. You've got 5 minutes left on the other side. Stay with us. Final segment in this hour. Open phones in the third hour, covering the terror situation unfolding in Europe. We're also going to get into some of the world news, economic news, financial news. Got a few minutes left with Charles Arthur, London Guardian writer, technology editor. My concern is this. It's just like they put Trojan horses, back doors in the phones to listen to us, and that all came out. And the cars have these black boxes to tax us by the mile, and now they're going to start taxing us. The big technology companies get together. They agree with governments. They put the stuff in there before it's even law. And then they control our lives, and the public's already unable to deal with that complexity. How do we deal with AI computers that'll be so advanced they're building the computers? And it just seems like a breakaway civilization to me, and where humans don't become the gods merging with machines, as a lot of elites say. I mean, I put that in my film Endgame I made 8 years ago. That's what most of them say. We're going to be gods. You don't matter. If you don't accept the computer augmentation, you'll just be like a bug to us. That's Ray Kurzweil. And he thinks he's going to bring his dad back off his notebooks and photos of him. So I agree with you that, you know, this stuff's a lot further off, if it's even possible. But still, the delusions of the establishment and their belief in technocracy, I think, is the scariest part. So I'm not trying to be pessimistic, Charles, Arthur. Any other points?
No, I think Ray Kurzweil has been sort of singing this song a long time, and I've never really seen any evidence that we're actually getting closer to what he describes, the sort of melding of the human and the computer. The thing is more that whenever you hear companies saying all these things that that they're going to sort of be huge, even the people, I think actually the people inside the companies, and especially the people who write the programs, are much more aware of the limitations than the people outside. I think that it's easy to think that the programs are incredible and that they do the most amazing things, but the people who write the programs are very aware of the limitations and of how far they can't go, because they know that if you try to go beyond a certain distance with a program, it just won't work. It just, it runs against the limits of where a computer is just a computer and where a human has far more capability, simply because humans are adaptable and have proven themselves adaptable over millions of years. So I Yeah, in that sense, I remain optimistic about it. Computers remain tools, and the way that people use them, and the way that governments or whoever or companies use them, is always going to be limited by the willingness or otherwise of people actually to sort of indulge them, and to use the tools themselves. So in that sense, I'm never really pessimistic about it. Sure, bad things happen when bad people get their hands on technology, but that doesn't actually mean that that everything about it is going
to
be bad.
Well, I tend to agree with you. That's why we're having this debate, this discussion, to get people thinking about knowing how technology works, being involved in the decisions, being aware of backdoors, voting with your dollars, voting with your actions to demand freer, open societies, as you do with all of your work, Charles, with the organizations you founded. People can find out more at theoverspill.wordpress.com or charlesarthur.com. Charles, thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, there he goes, joining us from the United Kingdom and the London Guardian. We're going to go to break. Come back with a little piece Shikari Jackson put together that illustrates how specter or criminal groups above government operate and where we see this terror really coming from. And then your phone calls, Jennifer, and everybody else that has been patiently holding, like Wallweeb and Justin and Jim and John and many, many others. Briefly, we have an amazing sleep aid that's totally organic. It's 9 key compounds. Just to get a bottle of melatonin of the same strength as these capsules costs $19.95. It's on sale for $16.95 and has 8 other ingredients like L-tryptophan and valerian root and other goodies to give you healthful, deep, restful sleep. Sleep is so important. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsLife.com, and your purchase makes it all possible. Survival Shield X2, Super Male, don't wait. Order today. It funds the op. We'll be back. Stay with us. You are a programmable guy that goes and watches Olympus is Falling and believes all this and really thinks you're a hero. G.I. Joe, great American hero. Yo, Joe. You don't work for Joe. Joe got taken over. The G.I. Joe command base is run by Cobra. Do you understand that? And I use a child analogy to get through to you because that's your main programming template in North America. They're on record with that. That was all Pentagon directed. Do you understand? You work for Cobra. You dress like Cobra. You have the tactics of Cobra. You are Cobra. Hail Cobra. You want to be little boys? Or do you want to really join the Republic?
They know what's going on at the Bundy Ranch, and they won't even let a police information officer give us any information. That's a bunch of bull.
It's all these stupid G.I. Joe movies and stuff where the White House is attacked. The White House is run by Cobra.
When I went through the process of becoming press secretary, one of the first things they told me was, you're not even to acknowledge the drone program. You're not even to discuss that it exists.
It's run by chaos. It's run by Spectre.
Special executive for counterintelligence, terrorism, revenge, extortion.
They run little kids. They run the snuff films. They run the drugs. They run it all. And because you act like a bunch of naive chumps, this whole thing's going to come down on us.
Very much concerns me, considering that they have all this bulk ammunition that they're shooting targets of children.
Would you like to tell me who it is that is doing this?
It is the Department of Homeland Security, sir.
Oh, thank you for calling.
To every police officer in this country, to every FBI agent, to every Secret Service agent, you work for Spectre. You work for Chaos. You work for Cobra. How do they get power? They stage a terror attack using Spectre, using Cobra.
Go f*** yourself.
Who is Cobra? Arms dealing, drug dealing, money laundering group wearing masks? They wear masks, ladies and gentlemen, because they're the corporate CEOs. And they're manipulating the governments against each other. Cobra runs the Muslims. Cobra runs the CIA. Cobra runs it all. Cobra is real. You can call it whatever you want. Cobra is in control of America. And Cobra says the veterans and the gun owners, they're saying that we're the bad guys.
These people who hold themselves out to be patriots are not. They're nothing more than domestic terrorists.
That's what Cobra would say. That's what Spectre would say. That's what Goldfinger would say. Because that's who those people are.
I am
am Supreme Cobra Commander. You call your petty bureaucrats, officials, and authorities, you will kneel before Cobra or face my wrath.
Resistance to tyrants is obedience to God. It's Alex Jones.
Thank you for joining us, Mr. Cobra Leader.
You pathetic little worm. How dare you call me Mr. Cobra?
We're going to go to break here in a minute and come back and go to Jennifer and others that are patiently holding and then start shifting into other news, not just the Paris terror attacks. But this is so big because our governments have funded these groups and have allowed them to come into the country. And we're going to have David Knight and Jakari Jackson popping in at the bottom of the hour to give their take on it. And then Jakari Jackson will be hosting the fourth hour today, getting into this, obviously, and a lot more. And we're continuing to break the latest information at Infowars.com on this front. David has discovered some interesting anomalies to this that point in the false flag direction. And he'll be in studio with us here in about 30 minutes. It's all coming up straight ahead. I'm Alex Jones, and you are listening to The Alex Jones Show weekdays right here on the GCN Radio Network, GCNLive.com. Stay with us. Well, Trump calls for surveillance of mosque. Black Lives Matter supporters release F. Paris rap song. U.S. intel experts warn of gaping holes in the security system and refugee vetting. That's some of the news up on Infowars.com. Gaping holes, they let people come in with fake passports. Our government helped create and turn loose the jihad forces that are now pouring into our countries. It's ridiculous how stupid they think we are. Meanwhile, we have really big threats that will basically affect everybody listening. Drug-resistant and drug-immune bacteria are becoming rapidly resistant. Everybody knows this, but now it's a growth curve. It's exponentially straight up. It has killed many members of my family in the last few years. Drug-resistant diseases, drug-resistant bacteria, drug-resistant viruses. We're going to be covering that coming up at the end of this hour. It's in the London Independent. Hospitals turning to last resort antibiotics as drug-resistant infections continue to rise. And a lot of these antibiotics will kill the bacteria. They'll also kill your liver or kill your kidneys. So we're entering a very, very dangerous situation, and it'll kill black people, it'll kill white people, it'll kill Hispanics, it'll kill everybody while we're all busy fighting with each other over what color our skin is. You want to know what I go to sleep at night worried about? Drug-resistant infections. So I love my kids a lot. It's a weird feeling not to be afraid to die myself, but being afraid for my children. But I can't not support life. I can't not double down on life. As bad as things have gotten in this world, I'll have more children if I can. Because that's what makes me work harder against this tyranny. Jennifer in North Carolina, thank you for holding. You're on the air. What is your take on the Paris attack? Some folks are criticizing me, saying I'm not saying it's a totally false flag. Well, I mean, it's too early to tell. But it is a false flag to open up the borders, advertise freebies, bring in people from terrorist areas. I mean, it is a false flag, but I mean, it just may not be the classically staged one. I'm somewhat of an expert on this, popularizing the term, I can tell you. But what's your take on it, Jennifer?
Well, you've been forecasting it for some time, and it just happened to be Paris. And now this time, we can look at what's going to happen here in America. And I was telling the call screener, I'm going out on a limb here, but if America doesn't at least consider drafting somebody today, I don't think the election is going to be, it's going to be irrelevant. I mean, I'm not saying that the people that are, you know, debating are irrelevant. I just think, with what you're seeing today, and you can forecast where America will be in a couple months. If we're lucky, there won't be any attacks here like Paris. I mean, that's just the reality we face. If it can happen in Paris, why can't it happen in Los Angeles or New York or a small town in North Carolina? Greensboro police just issued a gun control issue that if all the people in the area bring their guns over, they're going to give them a small gift. I mean, so it's happening. It's just to disarm Americans.
Absolutely.
Like the way Paris, this is concerning. And listen, I do radio too, so I appreciate what you're doing, because I started out in new media, and I went through like the back door to get into radio. So to get into an FM channel, I know what you went through to get to this point. But Alex, if we were to just segue and summarize what's happening, and you put the components of the Bible and everything that's happened on the world stage, we know we can forecast it through the scriptures, but to think that any of us have can wrap our head around what's happening in Paris, we could just look at what's going on with the border. And I just wanted to mention finally is that I read through Governor Bobby Jindal's executive order he issued today. And if I were to draft somebody today, somebody would, like him and Texas Governor Greg Abbott would be my pick right now.
Sure. Well, both men are light years better than Barack Obama or somebody like Marco Rubio. And I appreciate your call. They're all excellent points. I personally happen to know that Governor Abbott's for real, and that the Obama administration is digging through everything they can trying to figure out how to indict him. Now, that's kind of going to be a problem because the judge they used to indict everybody at the state level got shot last week, and I'm actually sad to hear that happen. That's still being investigated, but it does show what a strange world we live in, just to leave it at that. But there's a war going on behind the scenes in this country. And yes, Governor Abbott is a good Christian man who really does know what's going on and really is trying to protect Texas and trying to stand up against Obama and the globalists that are trying to cripple this nation's energy infrastructure, you name it. And he definitely deserves your prayers because he is being demonized and attacked and lied about 24/7. I mean, Rick Perry had great rhetoric, but he was not a good guy. I mean, probably good compared to Obama, but you know, Rick Perry used to be a Democrat. Rick Perry's a politician. There you go. Somebody like Greg Abbott is a statesman, like Ron Paul, and there is the difference. I mean, I'd love to see somebody like Abbott as a senator or as a president. The Democrats really screwed up making fun of him in a wheelchair. That's what I found about Democratic leaders. They're really, really nasty people. A lot of Democrats at the grassroots are wonderful people. It's just pretty much the same with the Republican Party as well. I want to continue with your phone calls right now. Let's go ahead and talk to Justin in Canada. You're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, Alex. Thanks for taking my call.
Thank you, brother.
Okay, I have a few points to go through. I'm going to try and make them as short and sweet as possible. I'm coming to you from Banff, Alberta, from where, as you know, there was a big globalist summit not too long ago. First point I have to make here, I wasn't going to make this point, but I have an article that I've kept with me for a while about the singularity and how close we might be getting to it. What do you know about the Google research blog and what's called the Deep Dream?
Yes, Google, when it was founded 16 years ago, said that the plan was to create an artificially intelligent master computer, and that actually all of us online interfacing with the search engine and all its other surveillance platforms is actually feeding a computer system through what they call neurons, digital neurons, to create the artificial intelligence. Is that what
that
you're getting at?
One point. Yeah, that was just one point, just because you mentioned it earlier. My main points I was going to get at, I just wanted to give a shout-out to you guys and Matt Drudge and how inspirational his appearance on your show was. I've always done my own political output and stuff, but something about when he came on, it just gave me the incentive to go make my own stuff, and it's been working really well for me, so I just want to thank you guys for, I guess, putting that out. It just happened to happen that way, and it was perfect. So to move on to the main point with the refugees. So Canada's newly elected Prime Minister Justin Trudeau has this plan where he wants to bring 1,000 refugees into Canada every day. every day until the end of the year, we have to have 25,000 refugees in Canada by the end of the year.
But he's liberal and handsome, so it makes it okay.
Oh, yeah, the haircut makes it fine. All he has to do is flash a smile, and everyone will just bow down to him, because it's 2015. So that's going on. You know, it's growing in Canada that everybody's politically correct. You know that. Everybody knows that.
And then what's he going to do when one of these people ends up blowing something up? Well, we'll just have the media say it's not terrorism. Great points, Justin. I appreciate your call. The bigger question is, why do we have to pay for everybody that comes to the West? Then there's the argument, well, our government's helped destabilize those countries. Exactly. And they're the same ones saying, bring them here now. Problem, reaction, solution. The globalists try to run all points of the compass. They try to opportunistically control and make profits off of every angle. So I oppose their agenda. Don't attack Syria. Don't attack Libya. Don't take their refugees either. You want my guns? When you turn your guns in. It's all common sense. Speaking of Matt Drudge, all the great crew from Jakari Jackson right through Rob Due to Darren McBreen, you name it, make these daily news reports that we put into the ads to make the ads informative and interesting. So they're not really ads. They're truly factoids. But this one is really powerful because it hit me that Drudge was here about 5 weeks ago and at dinner told me even more that they are coming after free speech. And then to hear the Democrats admitting that that's their plan. It's bone chilling that this is happening. So we air these during some of the breaks. Some stations don't carry them, but they're during the podcast or live audio stream breaks. You can hear them. And here is Rob Due's hot topic dealing with 5 weeks after Drudge was here, Democrats now admit they want to shut him down. People go, well, good. You know, I don't care. He's a big guy. They'll be able to shut you down too, folks. Appreciate this show. Appreciate free speech. Here's the piece.
In early October of this year, Matt Drudge paid a visit to the Central Texas Command Center and made the following chilling statements concerning free speech and his own site, The Drudge Report.
I had a Supreme Court justice tell me to my face, it's over for me. I said, Matt, it's over for you. They've got the votes now to enforce copyright law. You're out of there.
Well, now we have the words of FCC Commissioner Ajit Pai. He said, it is conceivable to me to see the government saying, we think the Drudge Report is having a disproportionate effect on our political discourse, Pai told the Right Online conference back in May of 2015. The FCC doesn't have the ability to regulate anything he says, and we want to start tamping down on websites like that. There are a lot of people who just don't like the fact that the internet is a completely unregulated marketplace in terms of freedom of speech, Pai told the website Inside Sources. And there are some speech that people just don't like, or they think that it should be regulated because it has an outsized effect on public discourse. And Drudge Report is one of those.
Time is limited.
Rob Due reporting for Infowars.com and Infowars Nightly News.
If you go to drudgereport.com, they have the National Enquirer headline, Charlie Sheen, AIDS cover-up. Charlie Sheen, HIV positive. You know, I've known Charlie Sheen for about 10 years, 11 years, and I've never seen any of the behavior that you hear about in the news. And I've stayed at his house probably, it's not exaggerate, 25 times. I know his parents as well. I know his brother. That's how I got to know him, actually, was through Emilio Estevez. I know a lot of other Hollywood folks. I know that he got a lot wilder over the years, so I only went over there and visited him a few times. When I was out in California, I guess 6 months ago, to give a speech in Newport, he invited me up. I drove up, had dinner with him, stayed at his house, and I need to give him a call and talk to him. I've never heard him say that he had HIV or AIDS. I've seen before magazines and newspapers say it a couple of years ago. And then again, a few weeks ago, but this is in the Enquirer. And so I'll try to find out. But I mean, I really don't get into gossip stuff. I really don't get into all those issues. I mean, even if I talk to him, he tells me something privately, I'm not going to pretty much relay it. But I just knew him because he had the courage to talk about political stuff. Also know that a lot of the so-called AIDS drugs are what actually kills you. And that much of the disease is a hoax. I do know that he did use drugs intravenously. And so that is where you can get it. He never used them in front of me and hadn't been on, you know, obviously. I mean, back when I first knew him, he drank coffee and smoked cigarettes and exercised all the time and was off everything when he was married to Denise Richards. So pray for Charlie because he's certainly not perfect, but none of us are. And he's got a rocky road ahead of him with all of this. But I'm already getting calls and stuff, you know, asking me my view on this. And I haven't talked to him. in about a month. And so I will try to give him a call. But it is certainly a sad headline, whether it's true or not. And generally, the Inquirer is pretty darn accurate. I'm not saying this is accurate, but the Inquirer, when I saw it in other publications before, I'm like, you know, that's bull. But it still could be a rumor as well. So we'll track that as it unfolds. Obviously, though, the big issue is the world economy's teetering on collapse. Terrorists have attacked Europe again. There's been a bunch of other terror attacks. And normally the media covers it up and goes, it's not an Islamic terror attack at the Army, Navy, Marine Corps recruiting center. You're a conspiracy theorist. Look at the Islamophobe Alex Jones. Well, I'm not an Islamophobe. A terror attack's a terror attack. They wouldn't say the Fort Hood attack was a terror attack. Killed 13 people. Was it 14 people? I forget. You know, these are the big issues here. And then I get back into drug-resistant, drug-immune bacteria and viruses. That's bigger than AIDS worldwide right now. That kills more people. Infections kill tens of millions every year, and it's getting serious, folks. It's getting to be a problem. You know, you stub your toe, you die. You go to the hospital to have back surgery. A week later, you're dead from an infection. That's the big issue. That's what we should be concerned about. And vaccines are lowering our immunity. Just type in, study, vaccines lower immunity. It's known. Feeding farm animals. Antibiotics makes them drug resistant as well. Waleed in Paris. I didn't even see that said Paris. I apologize to Waleed. I said, call me from Paris. I didn't even look at where you were calling from. I apologize, John. Next time I get a call from, it's not your fault, but from outside the country, let me know, especially an exotic call like Paris. Waleed, I apologize for making you hold forever, and I'll hold you over the next segment if you got good points. Go ahead.
Hey, no worries, Alex. I'm going to start by just quoting Paul's Bible saying, our protection against Satan's attacks is assured only if and when we take up the full armor of God. Satan's schemes are many, and he attacks us at any point he considers vulnerable. Thus, our armor must be complete. We cannot pick and choose our armor, but rather we must put all of it on. We must be completely equipped, or we are vulnerable to his attacks. And then, quickly, a second quote from, that would be from the book of Revelation. Our duty is not to attack Satan or to defeat him, but rather to withstand his attacks. So from that, I just want to point out that, like, I've been, I lived in France in 2000, back in 2008, and I'm living here now again. And from that,
stay there, start over. You've got an amazing connection, great points. I'm going to come back to you, Waleed. Again, I apologize that I didn't see that said Paris. I got these bright lights in my eyes. We got to figure out how to turn these lights down and turn the iris up, because it's just, I don't do as good a show under the interrogation lights. We ought to come in here with a camera and show folks what I'm under. I'm going to come back, sir, give you about 2-3 minutes to give your testimony on what's happening. Then we've got David Knight and Jakari popping in to take the rest of your phone calls. Jakari Jackson and David Knight sit to my right. We're going to be breaking down their take on the terrorist attacks and what that signifies and going to your phone calls. And then Jakari will host the fourth hour. Leanne McAdoo is going to be popping in. He's got a top expert on the humanitarian situation with human trafficking and how bad that is worldwide in studio in the last 30 minutes.
Yes.
Also, we'll look at reports followed by the crew covering Paris and more. And Leanne McAdoo will be popping in. That is in the fourth hour today. A lot of stations are now picking up. We're very excited about that. I want to thank them. But before I finish up with this breakdown, I want to go to Waleed in Paris to recap what he was saying, being in Paris and his take on the situation. Then we'll go to Jim and others with the other hosts that are with us. So go ahead, Waleed, and finish your story.
Okay, so hi, Jakari, and hi, David. Big fan of you two, guys. God bless you. So what I was saying before, basically, I'm just going to summarize those two quotes from Paul's Bible and the book of Revelation, basically summarized by saying that our duty is to withstand the attacks of Satan with the full armor of God. Now, when the Bible says the attacks of Satan, the attacks are on whom? Who are we talking about here? What do you think, Alex?
Well, we're talking about attacks on Christians.
Well, So that's a small disagreement there, but yes, Christians and what I would also say the believers.
People that believe in the God of Abraham.
Exactly. So that makes the Jewish, the Christians, and the Muslims. Those are three religion, Abrahamic religions. And
that's right. And Albert Pike said that they were going to have a third world war to play Christians, Jews, and Muslims off against each other. And PNAC says that's their plan, is to play the West, or what's left of Christendom, off against the Muslims, and that's happening.
Well, clash of civilizations. There you go. So basically, the main point that I want to make here, since I'm living in France and I've lived here back in 2008, so I'm actually like following up the culture change that is going on, is that when the Bible says that we need to protect ourselves from the attacks of Satan, we as believers with full armor. If you come here and you look at the French people, especially like the generation, the new generation, if you want to find a nation of sheep, welcome to Paris. So you've been in New York City, remember when you went to the CNN thing and everything, and you saw like how it's different from Austin, and you could feel the culture of sheep being there? Well, it's exactly the same in Paris, and it's even worse. Because if you look at the way people behave, like what they buy here, French people, most of them, I'm not speaking about the whole French nation, there are many good Republicans and nationalists here, basically, that still believe in Napoleon's visions and Charles de Gaulle's vision. But the most of the population here is basically spending their time in malls, shopping, buying American-made stuff, Apple products, and other products.
No, I agree. They are mindless, dumbed-down consumers. We see that here in the United States. It's very, very frightening. And so what are you saying in the final equation about all this?
What I'm saying is that they've chosen to pick the American products like Apple and others, and pharmaceuticals especially, and other stuff. But if you talk to them about the Second Amendment, they would freak out. They would say, never. This is not part of our culture. However, they choose to pick everything else from the American culture that is trendy and modern, but this would be like a huge thing for them, and that would be radical for them. So just linking that to the Bible, what the Bible says, when the Bible says that we need to protect ourselves with the full armor of God, and we see a nation of sheep here that is being attacked, the three guys that killed 149 people and injured 300 had 15 minutes, and they reloaded three times. Three guys killed 149 people in 15 minutes. Just imagine that. If one guy amongst the 149 people had arms on him, it would have been completely different. So waiting 15 minutes for the security of the police to come in, and there we go. So basically,
we're talking about a domesticated population. It's very, very sad. Great points. I appreciate your call. And that's a good place to start, Jakari and David. Obviously, Donald Trump has said arm the people in France, arm them everywhere. This will stop. Well, the head of Interpol said that, too, a couple years ago with the Kenya attacks. Yes. They've actually started some of that in Kenya. So there are these groups. I know David's got some evidence pointing towards false flag. Go ahead.
Yeah, let me say about the pushback that I've seen against what Donald Trump said, because we've said that sort of thing all the time, and we pointed that out many times and said, well, you know, what good would one person with a pistol do against guys with AK-47?
A hell of a lot.
We don't have to theorize about that. I've interviewed the guy that was in South Africa when they went in to shoot up that church. They came in, I think it was a half dozen guys with AK-47s. They threw grenades in and then started spraying the crowd with AK-47s. And he was all the way across the church, up in the balcony, and he had a pistol with five shots in it.
Wow.
And he took he took a couple of shots, and he said, I'm not going to hit anything from this angle. He didn't know it, but he had hit somebody. And then he went around the outside and back around because he wanted to get a closer, better range to them. And he got another guy there. And so they fled at that point. They thought they were being encircled. They thought there were multiple people. And they said afterwards, when they had the Truth and Reconciliation meetings after South Africa's government changed, they said, we went there to kill everybody. We were going to kill all 1,000 people that were there. We had enough equipment, you know, guns and bombs, that sort of thing. They were going to kill everybody in that church. And they went to that church because they knew it was a mainstream liberal church and nobody would be armed. Precisely.
And that's a famous case. Give folks the name of the case.
That was, his name is Charles Van Vick. It's C-H-A-R-Y-L-V-A-N.
And I think the book is One Man and a Gun, or?
Firing Bag or something.
It, I know we're so, teleprompter free. Yeah, we go off.
I'm trying to remember what the name of the book is. I remember him because we talked,
But we'll pull it up and tell folks. You've done a bunch of reports on that. They're excellent. But false flag, Jakari and then David. For me, whether it was staged or not, they opened the borders, they advertised it, they brought folks in with fake passports. What do they expect?
Well, just like you said, you know, if you don't have any type of check and balance, just like we've seen the reports, Kit did the hot topic on it today, that people want to come here to the United States. Of course, we welcome people who want to come through a legal process. But when you have such a large amount of people that want to enter the country, you know, tens of thousands of people, how do you vet all of these people, especially as the gentleman said in the piece? Well, we don't really have a process to vet these people. You know, if they've never committed a crime, it doesn't mean that they're not somehow radicalized. It's just they have not popped up on our radar screen yet. So how do you screen that many people if you just...
And it turns out these guys, one of them had been arrested, the others had warrants out. They knew who they were.
Yes.
Well, just think about it, Alex. I think it's about, what is it, 5 million people that they say have come in now, this wave of migrants that have come in? Okay. Let's say that 99% of these people are not violent. They're not radical. They're not jihadis. Only 1%, let's say. That's still 50,000 people.
That's an army.
Yeah, exactly. If it was a fraction of 1%. It
would folks don't know, in unconventional asymmetrical warfare, which is terrorism basically, in my view, both ways, whether governments do it or individuals, 50,000 people with commando training can shut down whole countries. I mean, with five guys, I could shut down Austin. You know, just knowing what I've read in books. Mm-hmm. And these people are being given terrorist training. Can you imagine 50,000 motivated people?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's like we've seen the shootings that happened here in Texas, whether it's here in Austin last year or this past year in Dallas. Me and Biggs went up there. You know, one guy, a highly motivated guy, you know, had equipment, you know, went out there and waged war against the police. You know, they eventually stopped him. But just like you said, one guy pretty much shut down a city. And when you have multiple people who may even have training and additional skills, you know, they can definitely do a lot of damage.
Look at the UT Tower shooter.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know, that's one Marine who's got a giant brain tumor. But see, that's one guy with a brain tumor, not 50,000. And I think that's a conservative number. So many of these, as you know, Jakari and David, they admit, are the ISIS forces that have been beaten, and they're allowing them to retreat into Turkey and get their retirement of being brought in as European citizens.
So when you talk about false flags, Alex, I mean, there's a lot of different ways, things that we refer to as false flags. Let's say the Gulf of Tonkin incident, for example, that Robert McNamara admitted before he died, nothing had happened. It was a completely false narrative. It was a complete hoax, but they used it to start a war, to start an agenda, to sell their agenda. Or you could have something like the beginning of World War II, where there's a lot of intelligence reports. I believe that FDR...
It was a stand down on
they knew. Exactly. And we've had whistleblowers, NSA whistleblowers like Thomas Drake, said essentially the same thing about 9/11 from his perspective within the NSA. They were getting all this intel. When they would take it to people, they'd say, don't look at domestic terrorists. We don't want to look at that. Go look at something else. Okay, so you can have that kind of a situation where, you know, the Japanese really did attack Pearl Harbor. That wasn't fake. They really did. But could they have stopped it? Could they, did they know about it and allow it to happen and tell people, don't look at that, look in the other direction? Okay, so you got that kind of false flag. And then, of course, you got the obvious false flag like the Reichstag fire, where they blame it on somebody else, that, you know, something that they did themselves, and they blame it on somebody else. So there's all these different spectrums of false flags. Certainly, they knew about these guys. They have created this situation, and now they are milking this situation. We've got Federica Mogherini, she's the EU's chief diplomat. Now, this conference that they had that started the day after the attacks on Saturday the 14th, they had already set up a conference in Vienna for all of these heads of state to talk about what they're going to do about Syria, okay?
They already had
the conference set up and running, yeah.
And the CIA had met with the French intelligence the day of the event, before it happened.
Exactly, exactly. And so what she's saying is, she says, let me underline the profile. And she said this today. At about 3 p.m. their time, this is reported by the UK Telegraph on their blog, she said, let me underline the profile of the terrorists so far identified tells us this is an internal threat. All EU citizens so far. And they say her comments may be part of a preemptive effort to help defend Schengen in the coming weeks. And, of course, that's the Schengen zone is what they agreed to when they took down all the internal border controls passing from one country to the other. So
that's the external border,
Yeah, the internal border, so that you can go from, say, France to an adjoining country, same as if you're going to go from Texas to Oklahoma or something like that. You don't have to pass.
Yeah, they're getting rid of their internal borders.
Exactly.
And they're talking about maybe we need to bring that back. Jakari, what do you make of the refugee situation? I know you had some articles on that here in America. wanting to bring them in.
Yeah, well, when we always go down to the border, we've talked to the ICE agents, we've talked to the Border Patrol agents, and they say, you know, like we always say, are there good people come through these borders? Absolutely there are. But with the bad people, how do you vet these people? You know, because a lot of them, even to talk about some more domestic issues, you know, people come in through gangs like MS-13. Like, how do you know they're MS-13? They're all tatted up when they go through the border cross and they interact with the Border Patrol. So, you know, you have situations like this, and it's very sad that you do have people want to come here through a legal process, but you also have the bad people. So how are we going to vet these people? You know, thus far, even the United States government, the top advisors in Washington, they're telling Obama, we do not have a way to make your plan work.
And so what's going to happen when tens of thousands, and that's only the first round, they admitted they want to go up to 300,000, come in and somebody attacks a school or an Army recruiting station, is the media just going to cover it up again?
I don't know. It seems like it's an issue that they don't really want to address. You know, like we always keep saying, you know, yes, there are people, good people out there, but how do you vet these people? Just saying that they're good does not really vet the process.
When I flew in a couple months ago from Italy doing those reports, they called me into the back room and started searching my stuff. Mm-hmm. And I kind of threw a fit. Then the head guy came in and said, yeah, you're not smuggling anything. You can go. But and I wasn't mad that they were searching my bag. It's that they knew who I was. I had no criminal record. I answered their questions, and they were messing with me when I was watching people that I knew had no business coming to this country just sailing past.
Well, even when we go to the airports, every time we go, last time I went out with Michael, our camera guy, they pull us over. They check both our bags. You know, they pat Kit down at the airport. Kit actually missed his plane trying to get out there, but the plane got stuck. You know, we didn't get it.
But the TSA admits they let illegal aliens fly.
Yeah.
And I'm not against the illegal aliens, but man, can I at least have the rights they got?
Basically, yeah.
I mean, you know.
They let the Muslim Brotherhood just walk through all willy-nilly and they
don't have to get pat down
because they don't give us the third degree.
Yeah, that's what I'm sick of. It's discriminatory against American citizens and it's wrong. I want to take some phone calls and get your analysis as well. Let's talk to Jim in Canada. You're on the air with Jakari Jackson, David Knight, and Alex Jones. Go ahead. Thanks for holding, Jim.
Yeah, I'm on speakerphone. Can you hear me good?
Yeah, I hear you pretty good. Go ahead.
Okay, thanks for all you guys do, man. It's great. It's great to have something to listen to and something to learn.
Brother, don't thank us. We're in this together. We love you, too.
Okay. Hey, I heard a fellow Albertan on, he's in Banff, and I'm in Calgary.
Gosh, Banff is pretty.
So we're pretty close. What are the odds?
Yeah, okay, what are the odds?
Let's play the left game. How about Black Lives Matter is ISIS? How would the left like something like that? And
I'm going to tell you, the same people funding the white supremacist in Ukraine are the same ones funding ISIS, are the same ones manipulating Black Lives Matter. It's George Soros and the globalists. That is a fact. And they're there to create balkanization.
Yeah, well, when they discredit Tea Party, why don't they, they're calling us domestic terrorists. Why aren't these people domestic terrorists? Because the kids just want to go to school and learn. Some of the left is garbage, but they just want to learn, and they're getting, you know, manipulated into walking with these other people. And
And there's real issues with the police and stuff, too. The thing is they're being siphoned off into a radical Maoist ideology. That's what this is. I've had the professors on that have gone through the Rockefeller Foundation training. This is Maoist brainwashing, all this leftist stuff. Jakari, your take, because you were up there with Kit just last week in Missouri, or I would have sent you to Europe as well, but it's your turn to stay behind. And you were there, you witnessed it. Obviously, as you said, some legitimate issues, but now to have some of the main Black Lives Matter groups complaining that Paris is taking attention away, I mean, this just sounds crazy. Do these people have no idea about the optics?
Well, it's a rather selfish statement to make, and Leanne made a very good point off camera. I was talking to her. She was saying that last week, you know, they were threatening people, they were shoving people around because they dare come in with a camera, and now the cameras have shifted from the group to the shooting in Paris.
Good point. I didn't think of that.
Now, they're like, oh, we want you guys to come look at us. Last week, you said, leave you alone. You guys are going to handle your own business, and now you're getting all mad and F Paris and all this other stuff because people want to look at a different story. And yes, there's no, you know, hierarchy. You know, there are issues with police, other domestic issues, but there are also issues going on in Paris, and people see those, and they say, we don't want those to come here. So let's do something to address this issue now.
Let me tell you, Alex, this climate change summit that's coming up.
I want to focus on that. Glad you bring that up.
Because this is how they're going to spin the whole thing. Right now, everybody, you know, they're coming out with their candlelight vigils and saying, we need to come together. They're going to offer the Paris Climate Accord as a chance for us to all come together.
With the new court that will go after extremists for even saying it.
Exactly.
Pass it for the dead.
Exactly. We've got two.
Maybe they did stage it.
We've got open borders and a clash of civilizations that they're creating here in order to take down Western civilization. At the same time, they're creating two structures for world government. One of them is based on economics and trade for the right wing. The other one is based on saving the environment for the left wing. Either one of these organizations can be used to create a new world government. They will have the capability of taxing and regulating. They will have worldwide courts and regulatory agencies to impose on people. They can finish the selective destruction of economies and cultures with these organizations, but it will also provide them for a structure to have a new world government.
And let's be clear. This is happening now. We're not saying world government's coming. They're suddenly admitting it.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jim. Great question. Charlene in Pennsylvania, Paul in New Mexico, John in South Carolina, and others. Your call straight ahead. Then Jakari is going to get up and go in the other studio, and he's going to host the fourth hour. I'm Alex Jones. And I tell you, you ought to hear during the breaks, David Knight and Jakari are having the real show over here, breaking down all the facts. And there's a whole fourth hour coming up with Jakari Jackson. Your station doesn't carry it. Ask them to please carry the fourth hour, where you can always find the free feeds at Infowars.com/show. Most radio hosts plug every segment, a product or sponsor, and I get it. They got to pay the bills. I do it maybe once an hour, and I need to do it more because it's very expensive to run this operation. It's very expensive to send three reporters to France. I said four yesterday, misspoke. I do that all the time. Teleprompter free. It's very expensive. And you get to see this reportage. We get to break the news. We get to challenge the narrative. We're winning. We're having an effect. Please buy the products at InfoWarsLife.com. We've got 15% off on the already incredibly low-priced Knockout, the strongest, healthiest, deepest sleep that we've seen out there. 15% off Knockout. We've got the Brain Force as well, one of the strongest brain pills out there, using known patented compounds to boost your overall mental clarity and focus. We've got Super Male Vitality, Super Female Vitality. You've heard the rave reviews of that. We've got high-quality water filters, Patriot T-shirts, books, films, shortwave radios, non-GMO, non-heirloom, non-hybrid. They are heirloom seeds at InfoWarsStore.com. And shopping with the good guys is what enables us to do all this. So I want to thank you for your support. I want to thank you for everything you've done. And I want to encourage you again to shop with the good guys and visit InfoWarsStore.com today and check out all the specials and check out all the products, many of which are absolutely essential in anyone's home or business. Now, shifting gears back to where we were. David Knight, you were pointing out who this minister is, who they've put in charge of EU security, literally no background, plucked out of obscurity, out of nowhere.
Exactly. That's the phrase that the Telegraph in the UK pointed out. When she was put in this position back in August of 2014, they said to get a glimpse of the backroom trading that typifies EU appointments. They say she's lacking experience. She's 41 years old at that time. She's been named the EU's foreign policy chief only 7 months after she was plucked from parliamentary obscurity in Rome and named the foreign minister of Italy. So here she is. She's a totally obscure parliamentarian in Italy. They put her in this position for no apparent reason, and then 7 months later, she's put in charge of foreign policy at the EU, and she's making all these pronouncements about how we have to fight this together, we have to come together, this is a global response as needed to control terrorism. No single country can do this. It has to be done globally. Every problem that they create, and of course we know that they've created ISIS, every problem that they create has to be addressed by global governance.
And she's probably also going to say leaving your door open at night will stop robberies.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's very surprising to see her saying, in spite of what other people are saying, that all of these people are EU citizens, and so this is an internal problem and not a border problem.
And what she's saying is none of these people are refugees, even though it's been confirmed to be the case.
Yeah.
She's lying to people, Jakari.
Exactly.
Oh, just like you said, they're lying to people. They don't want people to put two and two together because they keep saying, you know, you're a racist, you're a bigot, you're all this. You know, you have borders for a reason. If I go to Mexico, there's a border there. If I go to Canada, there's a border there. You have borders for a reason. And of course, you can bring people in, but you don't want to just drop 10,000 at a time.
How far can it go, Jakari? How far can these crazy...
I think they're going to push it as far as it can go. They're going to keep pushing it, you know, and until it breaks. Or it's already broken because we see all these attacks happening, but they won't.
And that's it. There's no accountability for politicians now.
Yeah.
That's right. They can do anything they want.
You know, it always interests me, you know, because you think back in the days where you had Nixon and LBJ, you know, people would go out in the streets and, you know, they'd shake the bars at the White House. People don't really do that anymore. It's like, oh, well, you know, so-and-so did something that was worse.
So the fault of this is we become so passive.
And because they let them move it into a racism, sexism mode, okay, to deflect any criticism of the government.
Exactly. You get demonized as bad if you anything. You're against Obamacare. You're against turning your guns in. They turn it into that whole politically correct mode. That's what's killing us. We're going to come back, do 5 more minutes of calls, then Jakari takes over. Stay with us, Infowars.com/show. And support us. We need funding, folks. Thank you for the support. Infowarsstore.com. Go there right now. Final segment that I'm honchoing, then Jakari Jackson takes over. We're taking your calls. Charlene, you're on the air from Pennsylvania. Thanks for holding.
Hello, Alex.
Welcome.
I was going to say, since they want these to let these poor refugees in, like Madonna and John Kerry, why don't we just put them all on the front lines? They like the terrorists so much. Why don't they support them? Put them on their front lines.
Well, what you actually have is a total coward's instinct by Madonna and others just to capitulate to things they're scared of because they are public figures. They don't want to be attacked. I mean, we've had ISIS actually threaten us, put Joe in their videos.
Yeah, Joe's in their video.
Yeah, I mean they've threatened us because we don't like them. I mean, so what? I can drive out there and die in a car wreck today. I'm not going to live in fear of these people. What about you, Jakari?
Oh, absolutely not. You know, they're doing these hit-and-run tactics because I always talk to people when I talk about, you know, open carry and things of that nature. And it's like, well, I'm not expecting to be attacked today. You think the people in Paris, you know, going to a concert, going to a soccer game, expected somebody to come in there and attack them? No. That's why you have a right to defend yourself, and you shouldn't live in fear of these people just because they may someday come and attack you.
Sure, and we're not inviting, and we trust in God, but I'll assure you, we're not a French theater here at this office.
Oh, this is a hard target. Very hard target.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, what I'm worried about is what's coming up with this climate change situation. I mean, we've got the TPP, and Alex, the way I look at this, they have a max of 45 days after this thing was made public to come to a vote on it. But they don't have to take 45 days. They can bring this thing up for a vote during the Christmas holidays, which is what they like to do.
They always
do that.
Federal
Reserve Act and all these other, the NDA.
The NDA,
all
this
stuff, yeah. So, you know, I'm concerned that we're going to get a real whammy in December of these two global organizations, a treaty for trade, a treaty for a climate, and they're going to sell these to the left and the right. And both of them have inherent in these treaties a transnational governance structure that will allow them to control us without any further input once they're enacted.
World government's here. It's an epic time. It's also a time where our credibility is rising very fast. And Putin's come out and said it's all a global government fraud, the carbon tax. Good things are happening. I just can't believe if you'd have told me 20 years ago I'd be on air and the Russian president would be fighting world government and fighting carbon taxes, I would say you're crazy. Mm-hmm. It just shows how stuff is upside down. Thank you, Charlene. Let's jam in one more, and if Jakari has time, he'll get to these others. Paul in New Mexico, thanks for holding. You're on the air.
Yeah, I want to say I agree with you, Alex. I think it's not a classical false flag, but it's an open-the-doors false flag. You know how in the first hour Watson reported that the security wasn't real high? I think that's by the design. The security is slack and, you know, lacking in effectiveness by design so that, you know, the operatives, they can attack what's left of humanity's free speech and leach away and breach humanity's
dam. Sure, and EU police and the French police had arrested one of these guys before, so they were even doing their jobs. They were ordered to let him go.
Yeah, you know, the system uses these tragedies and lockdowns in our homes, and they're going to transition that into mental lockdowns of our brains, you know, so we can't think anymore, we can't reason anymore, we can't be happy anymore. So we'll physically, not mentally locked down, you know. We'll be both mentally and physically locked down.
And I'm glad to end with this, Paul.
Confusion and delusion.
You're very eloquent. Please call back again when we have more time. I'm always amazed how smart these callers are, smarter than I am, the points they make. That's why I'm going to try to make myself take more calls, because it's just incredibly smart people, especially when I actually go to the calls. But to close out my piece of this transmission before Jakari takes over, that's it. Don't be afraid, folks. You got a better chance of a honeybee stinging you than terrorists. Know that good is there. Know that there is good things in the world. People are ready to hear the truth now. Let's not be scared by this. Let's be scared of letting the globalists use this to take our freedoms. Let's speak out. Let's take action. David Knight, when are you hosting the Nightly News next?
Tonight.
All right, 7 o'clock tonight, you're hosting. Jakari's coming up. Jakari, in 30 seconds, tell us some of what's coming up next.
Yes, we'll have Leanne McAdoo in studio to start things off. We'll try to finish up with some of these calls. We'll also have Govinda Tidball. He is a humanitarian, and he's fighting human trafficking. I had a chance to interview him before, and also we're going to take a look at the Paris situation. We have a special report from Watson, a very good one, The Inconvenient Truth, what they're not telling you about these Paris attacks.
Are you hosting in there or the other studio?
Wherever you guys want me to host.
Well, tell me, guys, where's your car going to be next? That's this one?
No.
That's that one. Okay. We'll be right back, folks. Stay with us.
And welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. This is the InfoWars Overdrive segment. I'm your host, Jakari Jackson. Now, coming up in this hour, we'll have Govinda Tidball. He is a humanitarian, and he is fighting the scourge of human trafficking. So you guys want to stay tuned for that. Also, we'll have a special report from Paul Joseph Watson and the rest of the crew out there in Paris documenting the situation going on out there. And Leanne McAdoo is going to join me in studio. But first, I want to tell you guys about the great specials at InfoWarsLife.com. You can get Knockout for 15% off if you have any type of sleeping issues. This is a great thing to help you get there in a very natural way. And it is a sleep formula. It's 15% off at InfoWarsLife.com today while supplies last. You definitely want to get your Knockout today. It is the holiday season, so you can get the Knockout. You can get the Liver Shield, all that great stuff. The Hillary for Prison t-shirt. You can get it all right there at InfoWarsShop.com. When we go out in the streets, we see these Hillary for Prison t-shirts. I don't know the analytics, but just from the view and the response of it, I think it's one of the more popular products out right now, at least as far as the t-shirts are concerned. So you can get your Hillary for Prison t-shirt today. Now, while we're talking about these great products, somebody who uses these products is Leanne McAdoo, and she joins me in studio now. And you recently went through the liver cleanse.
Yes, I sure did, and still seeing the results from that.
Good.
Lost 2 inches around my waist.
All right, 2 inches. So, Leanne McAdoo, that's what she has going on. All right, Leanne, you got some articles. You want to tell us about some of the hot topics going on in the world today?
Well, I know a lot of people were really excited with the release of Fallout 4. And
the video game.
Exactly. And so I just kind of wanted to talk about, you know, the new nuclear preparedness propaganda. So obviously, nuclear preparedness, this propaganda was really popular, like in the 50s all the way up until the 80s. Mm-hmm. They put these cartoons out for
the kids. The duck and cover.
Yeah, exactly. They had the whole thing in schools, you know, go under the desk and all that. Well, now they're doing it via video games. And so, which actually, you know, I don't even see this as a problem.
No.
This is probably one of the times I'll actually advocate for playing video games because the makers of Fallout 4, they actually commissioned research to make sure that these video games were as accurate as possible. So obviously, if people don't know the premise of Fallout 4, it's basically a post-nuclear war game where it's a first-person, I guess, point of view, and the player, you assume the role of survivor, and you're just trying to survive. And basically, everyone who's in the game, the only people who survive are people who were in a Fallout shelter. Well, what I thought was pretty interesting is that the American Chemical Society has now released another video saying, how can you really survive a nuclear fallout? So obviously the video game's gonna be a little bit, you know, it's not gonna be entirely accurate, but they've released a really informative video that I think everyone should watch. I think we have it there, we can roll it as B-roll, how to survive a nuclear fallout. And they reveal the basics of living in a world riddled with radiation and the very simple way to tell if you've been exposed to radiation. So I know we have a lot of viewers and listeners who are really into this preparedness, survival preparedness, and just making sure that they are prepared for whatever could be coming their way. You know, it's funny because every year they're ridiculed, these survivalists and things like that. They're ridiculed for doing this, but it's like so important. It's so
important. You know, the government's digging in. They have all types of survival supplies. They're buying the I don't know what you call them, the tablets to take if you have some type of radiation poisoning. Of course, they're buying bullets, you know, by the truckload and all this and that. But if you dare have some means of being self-prepared, they're going to attack you and demonize you. And also, we have information on that as well. As if you look at Joel Skousen, you know, he does the strategic relocation. He can tell you guys all about that. But as you were talking about the video games, Leanne, you know, I know sometimes we reference these things, whether they're in movies or video games or, you know, any other type of entertainment. And it's not always bad when we talk about them. You know, sometimes there is just some blatant, horrible stuff that's going on. But other times, you know, it's just something that's interesting. Another video game that's out right now is Metal Gear Solid. And this thing, my experience with Metal Gear Solid, I was like a 12-year-old boy. I was playing the video game. And that was the first time I actually heard about DARPA. And at the time, I just thought it was something that they made up for the video game. And then later on, they have things in the series like walking tanks and all that. And this is stuff they had, you know, I guess back in the 90s or whenever the game came out. And it just blows my mind how far in advance these guys, they get the inside scoop however they get it.
Right.
They actually put that into the games. And it's not necessarily, you know, propaganda. It's just something that they're just putting out there to tell you that this is like some real world thing. So before we move on to our calls, let's go through maybe one or two more of your topics here.
Well, I just think it's important to for people to view this or to take something like this seriously, considering how we have experts saying nuclear war is imminent within the next 20 years. Obviously, we have everything going on with Iran. There is a real threat. They're saying nuclear war between India and Pakistan, North Korea prepping for nuclear war. They've already got at least 10 nuclear warheads, and they're working on one that can hit the west coast of the United States. And of course, we had the Navy launching their tests off the coast of California at the most highly visible time of the evening where it would get the most press. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I just think this is something people should start taking seriously, you know, and not allow people to make you feel foolish because you are being prepared.
Yes. Absolutely. All right, now let's go on to our callers. I'm trying to clear the decks here before we move on to our other topics. Let's go on to John in South Carolina. Go ahead, John.
Hey there, Mr. Jackson. How are you?
Very well. Yourself?
Not too bad, considering.
All right, what's on your mind?
I just want to run through some points real quick, and I'd like permission after I get done with this, if I may pray.
Sure.
Okay. I think I'm a veteran. I'm 27, and I got out of the Army because I was called to preach. And one thing I can't help but to notice is, like, the secularization of Western society. I think we've sort of set ourselves up for judgment against God. I think radical Islam is a great national security threat. But I think if you're a Bible-believing Christian and you read Scripture, you also have to look at God as being one of your greatest national security assets or threats, sort of like Babylon. I mean, God didn't think Babylon was good, but God used Babylon to judge Israel. So in the same sense, I sort of see God using Islam to bring judgment upon the Western world and our secularization of kicking him out of everything. So, I mean, it doesn't matter how big your military is, you know, I mean, if God's not on your side, I mean, you're not going to come out on the winning end. Whereas you can have a very small military, but if God's on your side, I mean, you're going to prevail. You know, a minority is a majority with God.
Well, that's exactly what the Pope came out and said, just, you know, following these Paris attacks. He said people need to be preparing for the end of the world, not saying that it is the end of the world, but be prepared and get right with God. So,
all right, let's go ahead and give us your prayer, if you would.
Sure, yeah. Can we bow our heads?
Sure.
Holy and mighty Father, creator of all existence, I want to thank you for InfoWars. I want to thank you for the InfoWars staff and team and all of their hard work and dedication to putting truth out and trying to open up eyes and I've never heard them once deny you as Lord once on air. And I just pray that you would work through them as vessels and tools and bring this country and Western civilization to repentance and open up our eyes and just bring us back to you so that we can be prosperous once again and be that light on top of a hill shining to the world, showing the world what a good civilization and what a moral people when we come together can and should look like. And please forgive us of our sins and just help us to repent as a nation. And if it's not a sweeping tide like a Billy Graham revival, I just hope it's a rising tide of your people living out holy lives in their everyday lives and working at their car dealerships or grocery stores or offices and letting others see you through them. And we thank you for your sacrifice for us. We thank you for your grace that you bestowed upon us. And again, I just thank you for this InfoWars team. I pray this in Christ's holy name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, John. We're going to move on to Noel in Virginia. Go ahead, Noel.
Hey, good afternoon. Excellent show. Well, I'm going to talk to, I'm going to make 2 points here. The number one point was the attack in France, right? So on Friday, it was the 13th. So the 13th represents Babylon system. Well, what caught my eye, too, was number six. It was six locations. So number six represents the sixth chapter of Genesis. Okay, and if you read that, then you get a better picture. This was a another sacrifice to their God.
But you're saying it's a sacrifice here, to who? To Allah?
To their God. No, to their God. You see, the number six represents sons of God. What's above is below. Okay? So their sacrifice is to their God, Moloch. He's a, you know, when you do abortions, you're actually putting the kids into his, you know,
yeah, well, I guess I heard that there was actually another holy day or something for them as well, you know, not with the numbers or anything, but they were calling it another, it started with a G, my goodness, I totally forgot the word, but yes, I mean, there's they're obviously always doing these things on particular
days. Well, thank you so much, Noel. We're going to try to jam in Pat real quick before we go on to our break. Go ahead, Pat in Texas.
Yeah, I was just calling about an article yesterday from WND titled France Goes to War with ISIS, Start of World War III, question mark. Down at the towards the last paragraph, they're actually talking about Department of Defense and talking to high congressional people about putting all Muslims in the U.S. in internment camps.
Well, we've heard a lot of people talk about Muslims, what they're going to do with them. Are they going to start surveilling mosques, do other things of that nature? I'm not condoning that, but there's a lot of talk going on about that. Thank you so much. We have to go to our break now, Pat. We'll come back. We'll try to finish up with our other two callers, and then we'll be back after that break with Govinda Tidball. Thank you so much for joining us, Leanne.
Thanks.
This is Paul Joseph Watson with Infowars.com in Paris, France, in the aftermath of the massacre which took place just 48 hours ago. And of course, the big story to emerge out of this whole incident is the fact that at least one, if not two, of the attackers were found with a Syrian passport. They arrived in Greece as part of the migrant wave that we've been warning about for months will lead to these kind of attacks happening in major European cities. And of course, ISIS themselves said that they would import, they would infiltrate Europe with this wave of refugees. So now we get the backlash, the justification. The president of the EU Commission, Carl Juncker, has come out and said that even though this is the case, that they abuse the system, which we've been warning about for months would happen, they're not going to change the policy. So these waves of hundreds of thousands of migrants are going to continue to pour into the country. We've got Obama, who came out in September, said that America would accept 100,000 of these refugees. We had Hillary Clinton in the debates last night saying that America should accept these refugees when it's directly led to this attack. So now we get the left-wing backlash, the justification, which is even though this is proven, this is a direct connection, we're going to continue with the policy anyway. Despite top French security experts and experts in Germany too saying that this is going to lead not only to more attacks but to civil unrest. So we've been proven right, this is a major issue, and now we're getting the backlash, which is don't worry about it. It's all fine. They're going to come in anyway. We're going to vet them. And they're not vetting them. So we've got all these countries. Poland has stood up and said, no, we're not going to take any more refugees. And that is the lone voice of sanity in Europe. So for the people who thought that this whole narrative would change, that the insanity of Merkel in Germany, her mass immigration open border policy, would stop as a result of this attack and potential attacks in future, that's not going to happen now, because they're still sticking to their guns, and they will have blood on their hands. They've already got blood on their hands for this attack, and in future they will have blood on their hands for more attacks in major European cities, because now it's proven. Even though they say, oh, the passport was stolen, it doesn't matter that it was stolen. It doesn't matter that the individual who carried out the attacks maybe came from Belgium, maybe came from France. They stole a passport. They posed as a Syrian refugee to get into the country, and that partly led to the massacre that followed. And yet this insane policy that European leaders are following is going to continue. And we need to continue to speak out against that and basically make the point that if you invite hordes of these people into the country, even though the vast majority of them are fleeing here for economic reasons, some of them are fleeing from ISIS, there will be that small contingent which are radicalized, which are jihadists, and they will carry out attacks. So that is the major story to emerge so far out of this incident, out of this massacre, and we'll have more reports coming soon at Infowars.com.
Another great report from Paul Joseph Watson. He's on the streets out there in Paris trying to find out exactly what's going on, and he'll have more along with Joe Biggs as our continuing coverage goes on out there in Paris, France. Now, we're going to finish with our last caller ahead of our guest, so apologies to any other callers, but let's go to Ron in Texas. Go ahead, Ron.
Mr. Jackson,
yes.
Good to speak with you, enjoying the program. Hey, listen, I wanted to talk about martial law and how it relates to Paris. I think we were all riveted around the television on Friday night. I think it was Brett Shepard. Maybe I've got his name wrong, but he was the one that had Geraldo Rivera on. One of the things that I really picked up over and over and over again with his statement was that Paris was now in a state of emergency, was on lockdown, that the military had control. And I heard him say on two occasions, and then I heard Megyn Kelly later say the same thing, which was the military can go in to anybody's house, anybody's business, confiscate guns if that's what they wanted to do. And I couldn't help but think right then when I kept hearing this over and over, like it was a script, that is what is in our future. It was almost like they were trying to get in our heads, conditioning-wise. And, of course, it reminded me of that YouTube video with AARP, where in the background of that commercial on the radio, they have a message about...
Yeah, I remember that story. We posted an article about it. We're to the end of our segment, but I definitely understand what you're saying there, Ron, because we know during Hurricane Katrina, they went door-to-door. They used the excuse of a crisis to go door-to-door, confiscate people's firearms. It's definitely a very unfortunate situation. We don't want it to happen again in this country, and I definitely, if that is true, I don't want that to happen in Paris either. And welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. This is the InfoWars Overdrive segment. I'm your host, Jakari Jackson. Now, joining me in studio now is Govinda Tidball. He is a humanitarian who focuses on human trafficking. He's also a volunteer director of Community Concern, a vice president of Street Kids Worldwide. I want to ask you about that. On the advisory board of CARE International in Sri Lanka, and a website you can visit to find out all this is human2020.com. Welcome, Govinda.
Hey, good to see you again, Jakari.
Okay, so let's first start talking about Human 2020. We've talked about this before. And what exactly is that?
So Human 2020 is a civil society business community initiative that got its start around the same time that the global spiritual leaders made their pledge to work together to see human trafficking end by the year 2020. So this was, again, one of those news stories that was out there, but people didn't pay a lot of attention to it. But towards the end of 2014, all the spiritual leaders in the world got together and they said there's one thing that they can all agree on, is that human trafficking is an abomination to God, it's an affront to all of humankind, and that they committed themselves, whether they were Catholics or Muslims or Christians or whatever their background was, that this was something that they would put all of their faiths, make a commitment to see this end by the year, by 2020. So what we said too was, you know what, this is going to take a lot more than them, so we will do part of what we can do as civil society, as the business community, to support that global pledge that's been made. So the Human 2020 initiative is along those lines. And what we're seeing, though, is as people start to get more aware about this issue, because a lot of people aren't even aware that this is something that's going on. As
yes.
people are getting more aware that there's more people enslaved today than at any time in our history, and also how this is also implicating even global issues, even what you've been talking about today on the show, how this the issue of human trafficking, modern day slavery, and the factors that go into making that, how that actually implicates or how that actually impacts the global issues that we're dealing with on a day-to-day basis. More and more people realize the personal responsibility that they need to take in altering and changing the way that they approach things, their lifestyle, their awareness, and they're starting to get engaged in being part of the solution. And it's when individuals start taking a personal responsibility in the solution and realize that they're not passive observers or victims, but they're actually part of the solution, that's when things are really starting to change.
Excellent, excellent explanation. Now, you gave me this fact card here.
Yeah.
And one of the things that caught my attention is the average age into sex slavery or sex trafficking, rather, is 12 years old. Mm-hmm. And when we talk about these trafficking issues, this isn't, you know, I think a lot of people may hear this and they think about maybe this is happening in Sri Lanka or in some other faraway place. This is happening right now in the United States of America.
Absolutely. There are some 200,000 people enslaved in the United States today that are Americans. So there are Americans enslaved in America today, right now as we speak. And then there's people that are also enslaved that are brought into this country from overseas. But the majority of the people enslaved today in the U.S. are Americans. And this is where sometimes when we hear about things about the narrative about slavery from the 1800s and people relating to that and discussing that, this is what's going on today. So bringing some relevance back into the discussion of issues that need to be addressed and properly engaged in, this is part of what's necessary.
Now, you're saying this kind of ties into the topics that we've been speaking on the show earlier. In what way and what aspects do you see a similarity?
Well, for example, a lot of the international trafficking that we see and a lot of the issues that we see overseas are a result of poverty and vulnerability. Part of that is related to the financial systems that we have going on in the world. Part of that is related to how countries relate to each other. Lots of discussions about central banks and financial systems, how those work and how some countries just their economic systems are destroyed or people can't live. And so when people are put in a vulnerable situation, they are much more likely to be trafficked. And the result of that is that they're put into this meat grinder that on the other side of it, we have countries that consume and want whatever those goods are, because human trafficking is a business. That's what people have to also understand, is that there's a supply side and there's a demand side. And on the supply side, the more and more people that are put into vulnerable situations by the policies that are going on around the world, the more there's people that are on the supply side. Then on the demand side, there's people that are consuming these goods. There's people that are consuming the things that are produced by this and willfully staying ignorant on the subject. There's a lot of people that don't want to know what goes on around Black Friday. You know, there's a lot of people that don't want to know how these things are produced. They just want that $5, $10 good.
Yeah, because we hear about, we always talk about the Foxconn factories. Now, this isn't necessarily trafficking, but, you know, just the situations that those people are in.
Yeah.
Where they assemble the Apple goods. You know, the situations are so bad out there that they had to put up suicide nets around the facilities to keep people, you know, committing suicide.
Yeah.
And we see a lot of different situations where people are dealing with this. So we've been talking about the problem. I know you've been working on some solutions. You have some things going on here in the city of Austin. You know, what have you come across?
Well, what I'm seeing now is that as people are getting more engaged and as people are getting more aware, they are pushing for a few things. One, we're seeing pushes for legislative change. So, I mean, in the U.S., we've seen some legislative changes. We see these on city and state levels, as well as some things that have been pushed through for on the national level. So on the national level, towards the start of this year, they introduced a bill in Congress that's gone through. But even with those things, it takes some time to see those take some effect. With any law, it's only as good as the people that are enforcing it, and if it's actually formed in a way that it can be have some teeth and make an effect. In the city of Austin, we saw a resolution, we were associated with as well, which was pushed forward with some of the allies in Austin on this whole thing too. We're seeing even that is for the city council admitting that there's an issue, because we're a destination location for a lot of events.
We got Formula One, we got South by, we got all types of events.
We have 30 to 40 major events in the city of Austin every year. So we have, you know, almost every week we have a major event that happens. And statistically, we see too, wherever there's large events that take place, again, back to supply and demand. If there's a demand coming into the city for something, mm-hmm. the supply will also start to match that. Now, these are things that are happening behind the scenes. We've got the Because people are getting more aware around this, more and more people are coming to the forefront saying, what can we do? How can we get engaged? How can we be involved? You know, Austin, I really think that the police department here is doing a good job of, like, saying this is a priority. We're bringing to the forefront. We're going to work on this. You know, we've got a good police chief here in the city. I mean, he's a good guy.
Well, no, because I was laughing. That's why he said that. You know, I've had issues with APD. They know that. But I will give them, because even before we were talking about this, one of the reasons I wanted to get you on was a couple of weeks ago, I get the APD email.
Yeah.
I think I sent this to you.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and they had a real tough crackdown on the human trafficking. So, you know, I may have issues with APD on other subjects, but on human trafficking, they're doing a pretty good job.
And that's a good place to also highlight something. Even with all the global religions, they all have differences, but there's some things that we can agree on.
Mm-hmm.
And this is part of what the Human 2020 Initiative is about, is just saying, what's the common ground? What are the things that we can agree on? Can we all universally agree that it is wrong to enslave another human being and to profit off of the suffering of another human being? And is this not just on every level, on a moral level, on a human level, on just what it is to be a living being on this planet? And once we can come to that agreement, then we can also move forward with that. And then you also start to see who's even on that level, because there's a lot of companies, there's a lot of businesses that profit off of human trafficking. There's a lot of individuals that are at very high levels that can either turn a blind eye to it or sometimes even be engaged in that. And so this is part of what's necessary to bring that to the forefront. This is where, as individuals in our day-to-day, we have to be able to say too, here's what we can do that's going to make an impact. And it's the small things that people do that make a big difference.
Now, one thing I wanted to ask you, now you can correct me if I'm wrong with this, but you are also working on some type of initiative to crack down on prostitution. Is that accurate?
Well, not too many things in that area directly. We've been in a lot of dialogues with people that have. This is, again, one of these places where there's a lot of people that have opinions about stuff, and sometimes they're formulated in actual experience, and sometimes it's just because they read something somewhere and they think that sounds good. You know, like a lot of people in this country talking about socialism, they think it sounds good, but everybody that talks about socialism in this country has never lived or worked in a socialist.
All you UT kids who think it's the coolest thing in the world. Again, actually, that's an interesting story how I met Govinda. We were doing the protest outside of Planned Parenthood. And, you know, and the goofy college kids come up there, you know, talking about how they love Satan and, you know, they don't take baths and all this. And in the midst of all that, you know, I met Govinda, you know, a very professional gentleman. He said, hey, come check out this Human 2020 deal we have going on. And myself and Kid Daniels went out to your, you had an art gallery.
Yeah.
Just bringing awareness to all this. And, you know, and I think it's a very important issue because we talk about a lot of things. We've talked about, you know, people in foreign countries. I believe it was it in China where they had that van that ran around and snatched people's organs out? Just all types of wild, insane things that are going on. And they really don't get a lot of media attention for whatever reason. You know, maybe it's just too hard to stomach on the nightly news or whatever it is. But these are some real hardcore issues that people really need to take the time to face.
Yeah. And realizing, too, that the fact that these are difficult issues, they're also issues that have solutions. And this is something too that people, they really need to realize that on one side, yes, these are horrific narratives and these are terrible things that are going on, but they also can be solved. For I just spent some time up at the University of Nebraska. I spent some time with the Attorney General up there for the state of Nebraska. Great guy again. You got some good people coming in, you know, that are coming to the forefront. And he pushed through some legislation up there in the state. 100% unanimous vote. Making that for state law, and they're formulating their trafficking task force up there. So, but even in those discussions too, the head of their trafficking task force said, look, it's simple. No Johns, no trafficking. No, as far as for sex trafficking. Mm-hmm. If you don't have the buyers, you're not going to have this taking place. So it's part of it is people to realize too that the what they do in their day-to-day lives have an impact. And sometimes people don't realize the connection. So when we buy certain things, when we buy certain products, when we take part in certain activities, even though people think, okay, this piece that I'm doing, it really doesn't matter, or it's just my own life, it actually does matter a lot. And it's the collective actions that are actually what have built this system of trafficking and reinforced the slave system that we have today.
Very good, very good. Let's go ahead and open up the phones with, I guess, about 5 or so minutes we have. The number to call in is 1-800-253-3139. Once again, that is 1-800-259-9231. I have that other phone number like burned into my mind. That was like, that, don't call that number. That was the customer service. You can call the number if you want to get some great products. Number to call is 1-800-259-9231. That is 1-800-259-9231. Wow, you get used to saying the phone number much. Anyway, okay, so you can call in. You talk to Govinda Tidball of Human 2020. Now, Human 2020, that's an initiative.
Yeah. Yeah.
So tell us how, you know, if somebody wanted to, how could they get involved in that initiative?
Well, so right now we've got different projects that are going, different pieces that are like projects within that initiative. So probably the easiest way is just people to write in info@human2020, say kind of something that they're curious about getting involved with, and we can bridge them in from there. So like, I'll give you a simple thing that people are doing right now. There's a thing called 20 on 20. Every 20th of the month, for 20 minutes, whatever people's background is, they spend 20 minutes in prayer, meditation, but towards the end of human trafficking. Every 20th, people are doing this, and it's growing, and people are doing this all over the world right now. And people do it as an individual. They get together with some friends. They might do it at a church. They might do it at a yoga studio. They might do, but however it is that they do it, but spend that time and put that connection and that focus towards the end of this, however it is that you know how to relate. And what we're seeing is just something as simple as that. Doesn't cost any money, doesn't take anything more than just a little bit of time and a little bit of self-commitment, and just something as simple as that. You know, I mean, I pray in the name of Jesus that this thing ends every 20th for 20 minutes. And we're seeing every time that people make that commitment, watch, 2-3 days after that, you see several things just pop, you know, that happen with this.
Yeah, and speaking of some recent things, I have this FBI article, I printed a few of these off. It says a Henderson County, Kentucky man sentenced to 10 years in prison for human trafficking. And these are just some of the more recent events that have been going on that you can find on the FBI.gov website. Now let's go ahead and take a call. We have Mark in California. Go ahead, Mark.
Yeah. Vicki Nguyen on NBC deserves a medal for her fine work she did on the 30th of last week. If you Google Vicki Nguyen, it's spelled N-G-U-Y-E-N, child abuse. And there was this 4-year-old kid here in my city of San Jose that was just brutally, brutally beat. And she went to the CPS there, the social services, had over 100 pictures. And they waved her on, we don't care about it, get out of here. But it did air on NBC. Mm-hmm. And so David Cortese, who's our supervisor, we need to pray for him and the supervisors here in San Jose. They're trying to investigate it. But, you know, I originally ran for city council in San Jose because of the Nancy Schaefer situation where she was killed because she said the CPS was full of pedophiles. And I thought, oh, my, I hope it's not in California, because she had mentioned that it was in the other states. And she had proposed legislation to get rid of the entire CPS because they were full of pedophiles. But this poor little girl was found with bruises, bite marks, burn marks. And they knew about it. They knew about it, Jakari. They didn't do diddly squat.
Yeah. Now, Govinda, I don't know how far your investigations and your initiative run. Have you encountered any of these CPS horror stories?
Well, here's the thing. We've seen in some of the stuff internationally, what we see is there are elements of people at high levels, you know, that are engaged. And again, too, the wheat and the tares grow together. You see good people inside these offices trying to do good work, trying to do their job, trying to make things as healthy and as good as possible for everybody. Mm-hmm. And then you get other people that are in there in You know, we've seen it in the UN organizations. We've seen it in, you know,
government any organization.
Organization, really. And so this is back to, again, the responsibility of civil society and individuals. Instead of us making a blanket statement saying, oh, this group over here is bad, and this, and then discounting them entirely, realize that there's probably some good people in there trying to do a good job, and there's probably some bad people in there that may have access. And so surfacing these things, making sure that they're factual, making sure that they're objectively verifiable. This is part of what is necessary to and keep those at the forefront. Don't let those issues go away. So when something comes up like that, so like Mark, what you raised, when those things come up, make sure that those narratives don't go away until they're properly addressed, and then we keep moving forward with that.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Govinda Tidbom. Sorry to the rest of our callers. In our next segment, we'll be joined by David Knight, who's going to give us a preview of the InfoWars Nightly News. So the site is Human 2020. Anything else they need to know very quickly, Govinda?
Just get involved. Be part of the solution. Nobody out there is a victim. Everybody's part of the answer and the solution. Thank you.
My name is Don. And welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. This is the InfoWars Overdrive Hour. I'm your host, Jakari Jackson. And before we finish up with our broadcast today, I want to tell you guys about the great specials at InfoWarsLife.com. And I want to remind you that this hour is made possible by your support and your purchasing of the products and just all around supporting what we do here at InfoWars, whether it's the t-shirts, whether it's the nutraceuticals, whether it's any number of things. You can find great products at InfoWarsLife.com. And one of those products is Survival Shield X2. It's nascent iodine. It's ultra clean, ultra powerful, and derived from our limited supply of deep earth crystals. It's a win-win for our operation, and it funds everything across the board. You can get your X2 nascent iodine at InfoWarsLife.com. While supplies last. So you guys definitely want to get that stuff because the holiday season is coming up. We're going to have other specials coming up, so you definitely want to stay abreast of what's going on. Now, joining me in studio now, we have David Knight, who's going to be hosting the InfoWars Nightly News tonight with David Knight on the Nightly News. So, David, what do you have coming up for us tonight?
Well, Jakari, of course, we're going to talk about what's going on in Paris. We're going to have some reports from our reporters who are there on the ground. We're also going to talk about what happened with the Democrat debate. Nobody is talking about that. You know, not too many people watched it. Their viewership was down
45%. That's a shock.
Yeah, down 45%. But, you know, it's by design. They picked a Saturday night.
Yes.
And, of course, the next one you're talking about getting products in while you can right now before Christmas. Well, the next debate is going to be the weekend before Christmas. Twas the weekend before Christmas, and all through the house, not a soul was watching.
No.
You know, so that's what they're trying to do. They're also going to have the one after that is going to be the during the NFL playoffs, again, on a Saturday night. And it's also, Sunday night, and it's going to be before the Martin Luther King holiday the following Monday. So people are going to be out of town. They're going to be traveling.
It seems like they're burying these things, David.
Well, that's exactly what the other campaigns are saying. They're saying you're burying this for Hillary Clinton. And we can see, as we're going to look tonight, the many, many obvious lies of Hillary Clinton, saying things like 3,000 people since their last debate have been killed by guns, that there'd been 21 mass shootings. No, actually, there was one shooting, and it wasn't that large a shooting. There were four people involved. Three were shot. One person died. She said three people died. I mean, she was all over the place, Jakari, and of course, she was telling lies about her opponents as well as telling lies about foreign policy. And then Bernie Sanders essentially painted Eisenhower as a socialist. They said, well, how high is your tax rate going to go? And he goes, well, it won't be 90%, because that's what Eisenhower had. Well, we're going to look at the truth of the tax rates. We're going to look at what a real socialist, FDR, did to the tax rates versus what Reagan did. And we're also going to look at Eisenhower. We're going to fact check all that tonight.
Yeah, just the hubris of these people, David, to say that they could just throw out any number and nobody's going to go and look. You know, to say that I could, you know, walk off a helicopter getting shot by snipers and, you know, it happened. And then they come out with the proof.
Well, when you look at what Hillary has gotten away with, what Bill and Hillary have gotten away with, why wouldn't she think that she could say or do anything and nobody would call her on it? And clearly they don't. And most people, like I said, are not watching. They only had 8.5 million viewers. They had 15.5 million viewers at their first debate. And they're only going to have six debates. And I don't know what the next two are going to be. But, I mean, after these two that I just told you about, but those, the next two that are coming up, I mean, nobody's going to be watching those. They've designed that just for that purpose. They don't want to vet the candidates. They don't want to debate Hillary. And I don't think she's going to be a very strong candidate regardless of who gets it. But, you know, we can get into all this presidential politics, but it is important to look at the lies. And that's what we're going to see, is the multiple lies told not only by her but other candidates in the Democrat debate. So we're going to cover that as well as what's going on in Paris tonight.
Yeah, and I'm looking at this article, David, on Infowars.com. Brennan, Fourth Amendment will allow terrorists to attack America.
Yeah, Constitution, we've got to get rid of
it. You've got to get rid of that Constitution. Right. You've got to get rid of all the rights. You know, your First Amendment, Fourth Amendment, Second Amendment, all of them. So they can go all the way down the list. They get them all out of the country. So thank you so much, David Knight. Definitely want you guys to join us for the InfoWars Nightly News. Do you have any closing comments, statements, David?
Well, you know, along that line, Jakari, we've seen conservative talk show hosts cheerleading in the wake of this shooting in Paris, saying, I'm glad they shot Jihadi John with a drone and killed him without having a trial. Well, you know what? He may very well have been guilty. If he's guilty, you won't have any problem proving it in a court of law. But when you get rid of the rule of law because of the worst case scenario, we have to understand how this always works out. We've seen how the RICO statutes work. They came after organized crime, and then they wound up going after Christians.
Thank you, David.